Late last night, Michael T. Flynn resigned as National Security Advisor. I think the reason Flynn was forced to resign is Donald Trump just discovered Flynn never worked for Goldman Sachs. The Trump administration is imploding. I'm starting to think Donald may be in way over his toupee. Welcome to the broadcast. I'm David Feldman, DavidFeldmanShow.com. On today's show, one of the stars of the new CBS sitcom, Superior Donuts, Mondays at 9 p.m., Maz Jobrani is back to talk about his new sitcom and Donald Trump's executive order banning Muslims from seven countries that have never attacked us. And Howie Klein from Down With Tyranny talks to us about ICE rounding up children in Los Angeles. We got a lot of show. Let's get right to it. Joining us is Howie Klein. He's the founder and treasurer of the Blue America Pac, which supports progressive candidates all around America. He also writes the Down With Tyranny blog. A lot of people, Howie, are paralyzed right now. I've talked to a lot of people, a lot of Americans. You know, the media covers all the protesters. I know people who just can't deal with it. It's just so overwhelming.
I know a lot of like that as well.
Yeah.
I mean, they're just emotionally a wreck from this whole Trump thing. I mean, in a way, that's not a hyperbole. I mean, it's just all over the country, there are people who are just so petrified. And I use the word petrified in the way you would use it to describe a piece of wood that's petrified rather than just scared. I don't mean to be saying mm-hmm. that they're although many of them are, but they are just in a state that gets unbelievable. Because for me, I don't feel that way at all. I'm motivated for action, and I do action every single day without you know, 7 days a week. Literally, there's no day off for me, and I'm not, again, no hyperbole there, 7 days a week. So I'm action. I'm all about it. And yet, you know, one after the other after the other, I'm just talking to these people who are emotional basket cases over Trump. And it's hard to understand, but there's so many of them that I believe it. That's what you were getting at, right?
Yeah, and it's what Bannon wants, right?
It serves them to have that. Yeah.
Why? Why does it serve their interests if people can't get out of bed?
Well, they don't want people demonstrating. They don't want people protesting. They don't want people going to these Republican town halls all over the country, including in very, very red areas, and making trouble for people who support Trump. And then, you know, ultimately, of course, you know, Bannon would love it if people just don't vote at all. I mean, you know, he'd rather have them vote for Trump. But if you don't want to vote for Trump, he'd rather you just not vote, period. That's understandable. He would like that. But
yeah, I'm sorry, you broke up. What did you say?
I said it's understanding that he would want that, but it's not understanding that he would try to manipulate the populace to be in a state of emotional wreckage so that they don't vote. That's over the limit.
Mm-hmm. The way I see it, there's the micro paralysis and the macro paralysis. You see what's going on at a macro level and you just can't move. Then you get overwhelmed by the micro problems. My suggestion, and this is why I'm so glad you're on the show. I'm always glad you're on the show.
Thank you.
If people focus, if they focus and they stop getting into arguments with their uncle or trolling people on Facebook and Twitter, use Twitter and Facebook to vent, to get information, but don't get into arguments because that's not going to change the world. That's
just a quick fix of adrenaline, it accomplishes nothing. There are micro steps that you can take, and that's by focusing on the big picture. And the big picture is Washington, D.C., getting a new Congress, making the Republicans actually do their jobs. It's the only way.
There are many
to deal
people
with
can
this.
Do. I mean, you're talking about the political things, and those are very, very important. But I have a suspicion right now, I mean, this is going to sound really crazy, but I have a suspicion that there are people who are fixing up spare rooms in their house in case they have to shelter somebody. That's another kind of action that people have to think about. How are you going to protect? You know, you're on the East Coast. Here in L.A. this week, there were agents from immigration, ICE agents. Literally, this is going to sound horrible, and I don't want to upset people, but they were following school buses to people's homes. So they know the Los Angeles public school system has lots of kids, Mexican-American kids, and they're following the school buses to the people's homes so they could go and try to, you know, check out the parents and see if they could be arresting them. This is horrific. This is horrific. And I know, you know, I mean, I like to talk about the politics and what to do about this in terms of the things you were just talking about, especially electing a Democratic Congress in 2018. But there are other things that people are doing to protect their neighbors, for example. Very, very important.
What are the laws regarding that if you take in somebody who's undocumented? You said people are going to make room in their homes for undocumented people. What can happen to you if you do that?
I don't know of any laws about that. I don't doubt that the Republicans eventually will pass something if they need to. But if you want to take in, you know, someone in your home and give them refuge, I don't know of any laws.
Okay, so I read about this in Los Angeles, that ICE is rounding up undocumented workers and, you know, sending them back to Guatemala or Mexico. Wasn't this done under Obama? Is it any different than the Obama administration? Didn't Obama deport more undocumented people than any other president in the history of ICE?
I think Trump plans to quickly overtake his record. Yes, especially in the second term, Obama's theory was let's get rid of gang members, let's get rid of dangerous criminals. And although I'm sure that they didn't only do that, that was at least the theory behind it. What Trump seems to be doing, I mean, the first person that got sent back to Mexico was a woman who is a mother of two American children born in the United States, and, you know, just someone having a regular life here for you know, decades. And she, you know, many, many years ago, she did something, I can't remember what it was. It was very minor. It wasn't like anything violent or anything like that. And she has been, you know, there are certain things that you have to do if you're found guilty like that. And, you know, she has to go, for example, I think once a month or every specified amount of time, maybe once a month, maybe a couple of times a year, she has to check in with the ICE agency and just to show that she's a good, upstanding citizen still. And it's been okay for her for all these years. She went in the other day, checked in, and they threw her in the back of a truck and sent her back to Mexico. She's not a danger. She's a member
of
the community.
What is Jerry Brown, the governor of California, saying on this? He's a...
That happened in Texas.
Yeah, but what is Jerry Brown, the governor of California, a Democrat who vows to stand up to Trump, saying about the ICE deportations? Because...
Well, what he's saying, everyone's saying the right stuff. They're all, you know, they're all against it. All the local politicians are against it. All the Democratic local politicians are against it. But what are they doing about it? I mean, basically, they're doing is saying they're going to sue. They're going to, you know...
But aren't police chiefs around the country saying they won't cooperate?
Well, some are and some aren't, but the ICE doesn't always need the police chiefs. In other words, ICE could say, you know, well, we want the police to help us with this, or they could just follow school buses to people's homes, which is what they were doing here last week. And they don't need police chiefs. Or
following school buses, which means these are high school kids?
No, I mean, they're just not necessarily. They could be third graders. I mean, I don't think high school kids tend to be in school buses as much as elementary school kids.
And they follow the school buses and...
And then, you know, little Manuel gets out of the school bus, or Lupita gets out of the school bus, and these agents go running into her house with her and want to see her parents' papers. I mean, it's obvious what we're talking about here without saying the word, but this is fucking Nazism. Sorry for the language, but it upsets me so much that I can't tell you how horrifying this is to me.
Well, to lighten it a little, there's a listener named Chris Fish, and he made a poster for me that says, Godwin's dead.
Yeah.
Isn't that great? Godwin's dead. Yeah, you know, Godwin's law.
Yeah.
Yeah. And how is that being covered in Los Angeles? Because we're so overwhelmed. I'm on the East Coast. It's fun to go after Ivanka, Eric, and Bannon and Jeff Sessions, but on the ground, it's not fun. This is ugly and distasteful. How is the media covering that in Los Angeles? Because I've seen some coverage of this, but how is it being covered? Is it a big story in Los Angeles?
It's a big story in my neighborhood. I mean, you know, all around, you know, the center of L.A., everyone has Hispanic neighbors and friends. And we have a community that's being terrorized now. That's our community.
How do you see this playing out? Like, where do you see this, like, in 2 weeks, in a month?
Javier Becerra is the new Attorney General of California. He's going to court. He's, you know, going to do what he can to stop this.
He was a congressman. No,
he was a congressman. He's now the Attorney General of California. So
that was Kamala Harris's job, and she's now a senator. That's a very powerful
senator,
job.
Jerry Brown appointed Javier Becerra to be the Attorney General. In fact, I wanted to talk about that because the his district.
But just tell me, hang on for 1 second. Tell me how you see this playing out over the next 2 weeks, the next 2 months, and the next 2 years.
You know, pretty much there's a lot of sympathy for something that Trump said he wanted to do. I mean, I'm not saying there's universal sympathy, but there is a lot of sympathy. If Trump wants to round up a bunch of active gang members and repeat criminals and send them back wherever they're from or dump them in the ocean, whatever he's going to do to them, there's not that much, there's no real problem there. But he isn't doing that. He's not rounding up hardened criminals. He's not rounding up gang members. He's rounding up people from our community, normal, regular people, just like us, and breaking up families.
Because it's easier. It's easier.
Much easier to do it, and that's what he's doing. And he's saying they're criminals. I mean, the first woman that got deported, technically, I guess she was a criminal. She did. So I don't know, even remember what it was, but it was something on the level of shoplifting 20 years ago, once.
Right.
That was it.
Right. That was the woman. That was the woman in Arizona.
I thought it was Texas, but it could very well have been.
Oh, tell you, no, you're right. Okay. Let me stop for 1 second so we don't cause paralysis, because I'm getting a little overwhelmed. On this issue, what website do I go to keep track of this and help?
I don't know. To help? There are organizations that are helping immediately. I mean, obviously churches are trying to help in Los Angeles, but there are organizations that have been set up to do it. I don't know offhand what they are. I'll remember to keep track, and the next time.
I would assume the ACLU is.
ACLU, yes, that's right. I was thinking on the level of helping individuals in need, but yes, the ACLU is trying to help the whole class of people who are under this problem. Now, the good news there is that the ACLU raises about $3 or $4 million online a year. 2 weekends ago, they raised $26 million in 3 days.
It's two-pronged. It's easy to give to the ACLU. It's not easy to actually help an individual.
But there, like I said, there are. It's my fault for not knowing it offhand.
Right.
There are organizations, some that have been working on this for a long time, others that are set up recently who are specifically around to do that, just that. And I'm on mailing lists where I get that information, and I haven't retained it. But the next time you and I speak, I will have the names of those organizations for you.
Okay, I want to get to the five special elections that are coming up and Dodd-Frank. But before we do that, it's very important that my listeners be given a recipe. You're independently wealthy. This is, I don't want to say a hobby for you. This is a job and you're committed to it. And it's more than it's a full-time job, but you can dedicate your entire life to this. To the listeners who are in their car on their way to a soul-crushing job or just a time-consuming job, give them a recipe for each day. How many minutes do they need to dedicate to fighting this fascism? Down with Tyranny, your motto is, what is your motto?
You mean what's that thing on the top of the... the blog, it's actually putatively a quote from Sinclair Lewis that says, when fascism comes to America, it will be wrapped in the flag and carrying the cross.
Right. Wow. So we're fighting fascism.
I think so.
Okay. If you don't have the amount of time that you have, what do you recommend to the listeners? How many minutes a day do they need to take to fight fascism and give them marching orders?
Well, listen, everybody can only do what they can do. I can't tell somebody how many minutes a day they can put into this or how many they should put into it. What I think they ought to do is try to keep aware of what's going on, listening to podcasts like this one, reading legitimate news, whether that's on, you know, Chris Hayes and Rachel Maddow on MSNBC, who are pretty good sources. Also, Larry O'Donnell is a good source. And just keeping aware of that, of what's going on, and then it'll probably take its course, and people will understand what they have to do and how much.
I'm sorry, that's not a good answer.
I don't know
what
other people can possibly do. I can't tell other people what to do.
Yeah, well, you have to.
All I can say is you have to be aware. That's what you have to do. That's what I'll say you have to do, is be aware of this stuff. Some of the stuff I'm talking about, you know, when I heard about these ICE agents following school buses, it made me cry. Some people...
Yeah, but that's not good enough.
No, the point is that some people might hear about that and it won't mean a thing to them. But maybe something else will mean something to them. You know, people are, everyone, especially early on as we are now, it's going to take something to motivate people. The way you're going to get motivated is by staying open to what's happening. Don't close yourself in. There's a tendency for you describe somebody who's going to a soul crushing job, and there's a tendency there of to let go and bury your head in the sand. That's what I would say people shouldn't do, because that's how people like Hitler, people like Mussolini, people like Putin, people like Trump, that's how they get into power and how they can maintain power. We can't let that happen. I'm not going to tell people, you know, what they have to do and how many minutes they have to spend on anything. That's insane.
I will.
Okay. So
when you tell me that you cried, I immediately think, well, you know what? I've been doing political humor since before everybody was born, and all that did was make people laugh, and it didn't change anything. Crying and laughter and being in your Rachel Maddow, Amy Goodman, David Feldman, Jimmy Dore, Sam Cedar, Howie Klein echo chamber is valuable, but it's not going to move the needle unless you take action. So as long as we're a nation of narcissists, and before we get to the things we can do regarding the five special elections and calling our congressmen and marching, there are certain things we can do, and that is to personally reject fascism by turning to a vegan or a vegetarian diet. I know people are rolling their eyes, but when you don't eat factory farm food, you are fighting the system. How you spend your money, the choices you make, that's how you fight the system. Every day, the mindfulness of eating. We always talk about mindfulness. If you just focus on cutting a tomato, you won't have anxiety. Well, that tomato that you're cutting should not be genetically modified. It should be organic, and it shouldn't be from Whole Foods. It should be either homegrown or from a farmer's market. That's the kind of mindfulness that will get rid of your anxiety. Going off this hegemonic, plutocratic grid, rejecting the grid personally. Everything you do, you have to reject the grid. So when you go to work, you know, yes, you have to fill up, but don't fill up at ExxonMobil. What do you consume? Have the mindfulness to consume things that do not nurture fascism.
Very, very, very hard to do. And everyone is on a different place in evolution. So the things that you described are part of my life personally. And I've been doing, I mean, I became a vegetarian in the 1960s. Just because my girlfriend was a vegetarian and she started feeding me vegetarian food, and I didn't even know I was becoming, I never made a choice. I just became a vegetarian because of her. But that's a long time ago. So it's easy for me when I hear someone like you talking about that. But other people who eat a steak and a hamburger every day for lunch and for dinner, that's like a, what the things that you're talking about are very, very, very drastic. People have to move at their own pace, and depending where they already are on that level. I don't disagree with you with what you're saying. I absolutely agree with you. And like I said, I live my life that way. But you have to be, you know, you have to be gentle with people to move them along, and you don't want to turn people off by something that sounds like completely crazy to them.
It sounds crazy to them. You know what sounds crazy to them? We just talked about this on my show last week. This is really crazy, Howie. Between 1961 and 1973, we bombed the crap out of Laos and killed 10% of their population. We dropped more bombs on Laos than all the bombs dropped on Japan and Germany during World War II combined. That's what the Americans did in Laos to fight communism. It was a secret war conducted by the CIA. Nobody went to prison for it. It cost a couple of billion dollars a year. And we knew about it. Eventually, Fulbright held hearings. And we knew about it, and we didn't care. 10% of the Laotian population was killed by our bombs. Something they don't teach in high school, that we don't talk about.
You want to sugarcoat things? Don't forget Vietnam and Cambodia. They may not have had 10% of their populations killed, but Cambodia was destroyed as a society, and Vietnam, you still hear about people picking up some ordnance and blowing their legs and arms off.
So that's like a difficult truth, and Americans, unlike the Germans and the Japanese, who have truth and reconciliation and deal with their past, Americans like things sugar-coated. They want their truth to be convenient, as Al Gore would say. We don't talk about Laos because that's uncomfortable. And we don't talk about becoming vegetarian, even though we know that's the right answer, because it's uncomfortable, because we're not willing to sacrifice even that. You know, you're told to shop. You don't have to serve in a war, just shop. You don't have to pay taxes, just shop, consume, eat. That's all you have to do if you're an American. And we know that. The liberals know that. We know that we've been turned into consumers. And yet we're liberal and we can't consume properly. We can't take the time to learn how to eat properly.
I don't ever pull into an ExxonMobil station. Some of the people who are listening to this podcast probably live in a town where that's all there is, just an ExxonMobil station. If they want to put gas in their car and not drive an extra 20 miles, there's an ExxonMobil station for them. So that's what I mean by everyone is at a different place. You can't just...
But vegetarianism is easier than finding a place to fill up.
For you, for me, but not for everybody. Maybe they should just try. You know, I had a long talk with this congressman about it, Jared Polis. So he's a congressman from Colorado. He's a vegetarian. And he introduced a bill in Congress to allow, not to force, to allow schools to have one day a week where there was a vegetarian choice on the mm-hmm. menu. No one was going to be forced to eat vegetarianism ever. But on one day a week, they would have that option. And the Republicans went insane, and they tried to use that to defeat him, saying that he was conspiring against, Colorado ranchers. I remember when right. I was at Sire, I used to work at Sire Records, and one of our artists was K.D. Lang. And K.D. Lang was a vegetarian, and she did an ad for, about vegetarianism. And the backlash, and remember, she was a country artist at that time, especially. She got a little mm-hmm. bit away from that, but she started as a country artist. And the backlash was humongous against her. I mean, people feel very, very strongly about eating meat. It's far from my life, believe me. I want to tell you a little story, if I may. So I was traveling when this horror was happening in Southeast Asia. I used to literally wake up at night crying. A crying thing is it works for me. And eventually what it did is it made me want to leave the United States. I couldn't stand the idea that any money that I might be spending here in the U.S. or paying in taxes might go to killing people in Southeast Asia. I just couldn't deal with it. So I left the country and I stayed out of the country for 7 years. And I remember this one day, we had no cell phones back in these days. We're talking about the end of the 60s, the beginning of the 70s. There were no cell phones. And so I would go for years with having no contact literally, I didn't speak to my mother for the first 2 years I was abroad once. I would send postcards or they would send me a letter to Posta Restante in Kabul post office.
That for me, that would be the reason to go overseas.
I got a I got a letter from my friend Helen, who I went to school with, telling me about Kent State, and the murder of these American peaceful protesting students on the Kent State campus, where they were just shot down and killed. And she said that what was the American students of the day were going to get revenge for that murder, those murders of those students, by stopping drinking Coke and Pepsi. Now, that was a very big thing for me. In Afghanistan, if you can't drink the water, the American consulate would give you a handout when you went for your papers, where they would say, you have to double boil the water or you'll die. And double boiling means you bring the water to a rapid boil, you let it cool down, and then you bring it to a rapid boil again. And if you didn't do that, you can't drink the water. I didn't know that I was doing something wrong, but I was drinking a lot of Coke and Pepsi, thinking I would hydrate myself by drinking Coke and Pepsi. Luckily, I was young enough not to die from that, although I suspect, and one of my doctors has confirmed to me, that eventually could possibly have led to me getting cancer. In any case, when my friend Helen said, we're going to boycott Coke and Pepsi and bring down those companies, I immediately stopped on the spot. I never drank another Coke or another Pepsi. This, I don't know, 1971, was that the year that happened? I never drank a Coke or a Pepsi or any other soft drink since then, ever. Helen, who's still a very close friend of mine, doesn't remember even telling me that. I've never met anybody who's ever heard of that. But yet that became part of my ingrained life. And it was a mm-hmm. political move because I just felt the National Guard going onto a college campus and shooting dead protesting students. They were protesting the war. That can't stand. So
I'm kind of obsessing on Laos. I didn't know how bad it was. I know that President Obama went there in September and apologized and literally said America dropped more bombs on Laos than were dropped on Germany and Japan combined. The president admitted that. I don't know. For some reason now I'm fixating on it. One of the things that I read was Kent State was to protest Cambodia, the illegal secret bombings and invasion of Cambodia. At the time, we knew about Laos, but the anti-war movement didn't care because it was a CIA war using the Air Force. No Americans were dying. They cared more about Cambodia because American lives were lost in Cambodia, and they were sending our soldiers into Cambodia. We were only bombing
Laos. I think we were only bombing Cambodia, too. I don't think Americans were on the ground there. They were on the ground.
I think John Kerry, I think some Swift boats went in there. Didn't John Kerry and the Swift boats?
I think he was in Vietnam.
Yeah, but he said that he was accused of lying about this, about taking his Swift boat into Cambodia.
Oh, maybe he did. I mean, there were also Americans training Laotians, by the way. They were on the ground there, too.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And finally, Coke is a Democratic soft drink, and Pepsi is a Republican. That's my theory. Nixon worked for Pepsi, and Pepsi was all about Russia, getting into the Russian market. And Coca-Cola is from Georgia, and they put Jimmy Carter in office, and they had strong Democratic roots. That's my crazy theory.
You can drive your listeners insane by this kind of talk.
I know. Vegetarianism, that's a way to deal with stuff on a micro level, to reject the system. 5 special elections are coming up. Rahm Emanuel said, take a chill pill, folks. We're not going to win 2018. What do you say?
Well, Rahm Emanuel is wrong about everything. And if he says, you know, left, then right is the right answer. If he says up, then down is the right answer. Rahm Emanuel, okay. I don't get me started on Rahm Emanuel, please. I mean, the other night,
okay.
Someone... who was it? Oh, it was Chris Hayes again. Was on MSNBC doing a like a town hall in Chicago, and some guy stood up and started talking about how Rahm Emanuel doesn't give a shit about black people, and just going on and on about how terrible Rahm Emanuel was. And there was immediately, you know, 20 tweets from people who I don't know personally, but who I know from Twitter, who were saying, oh, I hope Howie Klein is listening to this now. I mean, Rahm Emanuel and I almost once got into a fist fight. The only thing that stopped it from happening was a friend of mine coming over and snapping his picture, and at which point he backed off from wanting to attack me physically.
When was this?
This is when he was the chairman of the DCCC. It's a great story. But it's very off the topic. He was the chairman of the DCCC. The DCCC, this was in, I think, 2006. And they were just learning how to use the internet to raise money. And I had been doing it, and I knew sort of how to do it. I identified him as the enemy. I didn't identify the DCCC as an institutional enemy. I did later, but at that time I didn't. And they asked me if I would come to Washington and show them how to do it. And I said, sure. So I did, and they asked me if I want to have dinner. So I said, yes, but don't bring Rahm along. And everyone laughed, and they said, there's a fire hydrant in front of the restaurant, and maybe we'll leave him tied up to the fire hydrant. Everyone had a good chuckle. Mm-hmm. So we were eating, and the restaurant, by the way, was on the same block as the DCCC building. So we were eating, and I had my back to the door, and then this friend of mine, Jane, says, oh, Howie, your friend just walked in. And immediately the two guys from the DCCC literally sunk under the table. Like they were no longer visible. And I said to them, he doesn't know what I look like. Don't worry. And they both realized, and they sort of got up timidly, and they sat there uncomfortably. until I got up, walked over to Rahm's, put my hand out, and he instinctively went to shake my hand. And then as he was doing that, I said, "Hi, I'm Howie Klein." At which point he all of the blood drained out of his face, and he looked like he was about to kill me. And that's when my friend Jane came over and took the picture. I wrote about this in real time, by the way. So I have it's a great story, and it's on my blog, and I don't think I did it justice just now.
Did he work for Goldman Sachs after Clinton?
I don't think he ever worked necessarily for them. He worked for other, I can't remember the name of it, like Swinehunt and something or something. He worked for some horrible sounding Wall Street firm, and he didn't have a real job. It was just a way of paying him off. So he had a payoff job. He didn't know anything about being a bankster, and they basically transferred. I don't remember the exact number. I think it was $23 million to him over the course of about a year and a half, making him independently wealthy, and so that he could, you know, go about doing politics and serving their interests. So in other words, Wall Street gave him all this money, and, you know, by giving him this, you know, silly job that he didn't do anything for. And now he's very wealthy and doesn't have to worry about where his money's going to come from. And he can just serve their interests, which he does.
He worked in the Clinton White House.
What did he do, you might ask? What did he do in the Clinton White House? First, he was raising money for Clinton's campaign. So that was his first job. Then the first time the public became aware of Rahm Emanuel, the first time the horror of what that scumbag is all about, was he was the guy who was charged by Clinton to pass NAFTA. George H.W. Bush had tried to pass, it was his bill, he tried to pass his treaty, he tried to pass NAFTA, but the there were enough Republicans and a lot of Democrats who were opposed to it, and Bush couldn't get it through. Clinton, who's as big a piece of shit, sorry again for my language, I get very
No, you're being polite.
He's as big a piece of shit as Bush in some ways, certainly in this way, said to the corporate America folks who financed his campaign, "Hey, I'll get this passed for you." And the way he did that was by assigning Rahm Emanuel to go into Congress and work with Tom DeLay on breaking arms and bribing people. So some people, you give them something to change their vote, to vote for NAFTA. Other people, you have to threaten them. And both Tom DeLay and Rahm Emanuel did that, and they got NAFTA passed by, I believe, one vote. If it wasn't one vote, it was two votes. It was some tiny amount passed this horrible NAFTA. And it was Rahm Emanuel who we can owe that to. So, and then his reward for that was this make-believe job at, you know, I don't know, Kleinwort or something. It's some firm that doesn't exist anymore, but a Wall Street firm. He was the head of their Chicago office or something like that. And he worked for a few years, got all those millions and millions of dollars, and then went right back into politics. He was a freshman. He comes in as a freshman and immediately is given the job as head of the DCCC. And what does he start doing? He starts recruiting ex-Republicans and extremely pro-Wall Street Democrats to run as Democratic candidates. So when the Democrats won back the House, loads and loads and loads of those candidates, all of whom were eventually defeated. In other words, they won seats, although the next year or the year after, they lost the seats because they weren't real Democrats, and the Democratic base didn't want to vote for them. But Rahm, they were all Rahm's draftees, and they were just a terrible bunch. So that's Rahm Emanuel. Why did we bring him up? Why, how did this monster come back into our consciousness?
Because we're going to talk about Dodd-Frank. You say that one-third of Democratic congressmen are in Wall Street's pocket.
I would call them the Republican wing of the Democratic Party. So they call themselves the Blue Dogs and the New Dems. The New Dems, which is headed by a former Goldman Sachs guy named Jim Himes, a conservative Connecticut corrupt congressman. He's the head of the New Dems now, although the head of the Democratic House caucus, Joe Crowley, he was the head of the New Dems, and he and Himes control it together. So he's the third ranking or the fourth ranking Democrat in the House, and he also controls the New Dems. And the New Dems are paid for by Wall Street. They are all the people who join are paid off by Wall Street. I ran a post the other day about how the Republicans are bringing down Dodd-Frank and how they're taking it apart piece by piece, and every day there's another piece that comes down. And I, as part of that post on my blog, I ran a chart, and the chart had has a list of the members of Congress that took the most in what I call bribes. Now, it's unfair in some ways to call it bribes because it's legal. So then I'll say, okay, legalistic bribes. But basically, these are the people who do Wall Street's bidding, and they just happen to be the people that get huge amounts of money from Wall Street. And it's not like Wall Street gives $1 million to every member of Congress. They only give it to a certain people, and that's what my post was about. And I listed all of those people, most of whom are Republicans, but some of them are Democrats. So I was talking about basically just the year 2016. So I wasn't going back into people's whole careers, which you can do as well. I was just talking about people who are in Congress now and who got huge payoffs. For example, I'll just give you a couple of obvious examples. So the Speaker of the House who runs the show over there is Paul Ryan. So what did Wall Street people, what did they give Paul Ryan in 2016? You want to make a guess, David?
Couple hundred thousand.
$4,385,014. So let's round that off to just $4.3 million.
That's a couple of hundred thousand.
1 year only.
What does he do with that?
Well, he uses it to build his power. In other words, he'll give it to other Republicans. I mean, there are a lot of things you can do with it. And one of the tragedies that people don't understand is you can bank it. And then when you retire, then you pay your wife or your brother to take care of it for you. And you can pay them a lot of money to take care of it for you. So in other words, it's a way you can line your own pocket, which many people do. But at this point in Ryan's career, I would say he's probably using the money to buy the love of his fellow Republicans. That's what you do. And in return, he makes sure that the people who are giving him that money get their agendas passed. He lets them write the legislation. So he took in 2016 the most money by far of anyone in Congress. I'm talking about the House from Wall Street. Number two, Kevin McCarthy. Who's Kevin McCarthy? He's the number two Republican in the House. He's the House Majority Leader. $2.1 million. And then you get to all of these Republicans on the House Financial Services Committee, the ones who are specifically doing the taking apart of Dodd-Frank. So the guy who really wants to end Dodd-Frank, who wants to kill the Consumer Protection Bureau and is killing that bureau, is Jeb Hensarling, a right-wing Republican from Texas. You know, he's gotten, in the course of his career, over $7 million from Wall Street. Last year alone, $1.2 million. This is pretty disgusting. But then, if you look down the list, it's mostly all Republicans, but as you look down the list, you see Joe Crowley, the number four Democrat in the House, $1 million. Kyrsten Sinema, the single most conservative Democrat in the House, over $1 million. Jim Himes, who I've mentioned to you as the head of the New Dems, just almost $1 million, $984,000. So this is the problem, that these people, their careers are being paid for by Wall Street. They're going to do what Wall Street wants them to do, and they do. And right now, what that is Wall Street hates the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, and they want it destroyed, and these people are destroying it. That's what they're doing. They're putting in every kind of piece of legislation you could think of and changing the rules and doing whatever they can. So the one hope that people had, which was insane, but people had a hope that because Trump said he's going to drain the swamp and there are too many – I mean, he specifically talked about these things. He said there are too many Goldman Sachs people in Washington. I'm going to change that. Well, now there are more Goldman Sachs people in Washington than ever before. And he's already said he's going to sign this legislation, and it's great legislation. So much for Donald Trump.
What happens to these Trump supporters when it doesn't get better? We go to war, right? Then he takes us to war. Then he whips out the flag and the Bible.
Presumably,
right?
that's one possibility. Or he'll bluff around about how he's making their lives better. And these people are, you know, I did a post the other day, which took a lot of research and it took a lot of time, and I found the 30 counties in the United States that have the worst outcome from prescription drugs abuse. So these are people who manage somehow to get prescription drugs, and we're not talking about just, you know, someone who abuses a little bit. We're talking about the 30 counties where virtually everyone in the county is addicted to fentanyl or Oxycontin. There are four drugs that are the things you look at is how many people per month die of overdoses. Another thing that I was able to come up with, which was amazing that I found online, was the number at any one time of, for example, Oxycontin, the number of pills per person in these counties. And in some cases, it was the worst cases, it was over 700 pills per person at any one time. So we're talking about really extreme cases here. So 30 counties. Of the 30 counties, 29 of them, so pretty significant, 29 out of 30, the people in those counties who are so drug addicted, I mean, I'm talking about whole counties being drug addicted and in a terrible way, whole counties voted above 75% for Trump. Some of them above 85% for Trump. We're talking about counties spread around the country. I mean, you know, most of them are in West Virginia and Kentucky. But, you know, there were counties in Utah, in North Carolina, in Tennessee. I mean, they're all over the United States. But these are the most extreme cases. So what I was getting at is that a very large number of Trump supporters are mentally impaired from severe drug addiction, untreated severe drug addiction. You think you're going to be able to change their minds about anything? I have a feeling not. He may not have to go to war. Polling has shown, I'm sure you're reading the same polls that I am, and as your listeners are, but it is showing again and again and again that you say, do you think, or even open-ended, like why should Trump be able to overturn judges? And they'll give as an example the massacre in Bowling Green, the horrible massacre by Iraqi immigrants. Now, the fact that it's already been proven without any doubt that there never was a massacre in Bowling Green, that it was made up by Kellyanne Conway, it's just fake news. It doesn't matter to them. Most Americans know that and are aware that that's fake news and it's not real and it's old, what do they call it, old facts, alternative facts? It's not real.
Yeah.
But to the majority of Trump supporters, it's completely real. That's as real as anything else, and as real as the wall that you're standing in front of, as real as your car is the fact, and they will never, ever get over it, that there was a massacre of innocent people in Bowling Green.
We went into the Spanish-American War remembering the Maine. We were lied to about the Maine.
Although there was actually a Maine. I mean, there was a ship called the Maine. There was a explosion on the Maine. They lied about what it was and how it happened. Yes, and they remember the Maine. But the Bowling Green massacre was just made up. I mean, there was no massacre. There wasn't even like someone sticking out their tongue at somebody. There was nothing.
Maybe we've reached a new stage in waging war. You know, the Gulf of Tonkin was an actual incident. There were ships attacked by the North Vietnamese.
Yeah, it wasn't real. It was something.
But it was something.
Bowling Green massacre was nothing. No one even gave someone the finger. There was nothing.
Wouldn't it be great, Howie, if we can finally go to war without Americans or anybody having to die as the provocation? Wouldn't it be great to fight a war because of the Bowling Green Massacre? We're saving lives. Nobody had to die for an excuse to go to war. That's a good thing.
Okay.
All right. So what are you going to do? I've thought about this. What do I do after the next terrorist attack? And as Ari Fleischer said, after Bill Maher got fired, we all have to watch what we say. 9/11 happened, and Ari Fleischer, George W. Bush's press spokesman, said everybody has to watch what they say right now.
I have Down With Tyranny writers and commenters who don't want to use their names because they're afraid.
They're afraid. Have we been inoculated by George W. Bush? In other words, are the people going to rise up since we were lied to about Iraq? Are people going to remember that and rise up and know that this guy is an inveterate liar and cannot be trusted to send us into war?
People who are listening to your podcast know, and everybody else doesn't.
How frightened are you?
Not frightened at all.
Okay, next week.
I love it. Thank you. Bye.
You do something wrong, you got to go away. You got to do time. You got to disappear. For some reason in America, there are no consequences unless you're a person of color. If you're a black guy and you run a red light, you go to prison. Everybody else, redemption. 2 million people behind bars in this country, more than 2 million people behind bars in this country. No room for corporate CEOs, no room for the white men who got us into the war in Iraq, no room for anybody other than people of color who deal drugs. That's basically who we have in prison. I want to talk about Ari Fleischer, Bill Kristol, David Frum, Elliot Abrams, Henry Kissinger, Mike Flynn. That's who I'm going to talk about for a little while here. Because these are deeply flawed human beings who are responsible, many of them are responsible for death and destruction. Never went to prison, never apologized, just rear their hideous head, a head that's as ugly on the outside as it is on the inside. And people care what they think, as long as they color within the lines using a red crayon. Or a blue crayon, Larry Summers, the former Treasury Secretary under Clinton, Rahm Emanuel. They get to color with the blue crayon. They're partly responsible for the housing crash, the Great Recession of 2008. As long as you use a red crayon or a blue crayon, you're allowed to speak in this country, and it doesn't matter what you've done. And I fall prey to that. Out of fear, I always cling to, hey, I'm a Democrat. I'm working within the system. Because when you say I'm a Democrat, there's cover. There have to be consequences in this country, especially for the rich and powerful. Christianity is all about forgiveness. Jesus teaches us to turn the other cheek, forgive. And that's why politicians hide behind the Bible, why they hide behind Jesus, because they are going to screw up. They are going to make tremendous mistakes. They asked George W. Bush when he was running for president, who is the greatest philosopher? And he said, Jesus. When you present yourself as a true believer, when you fall, people automatically begin to forgive you. They say, you know, life is too short. Let it go. He's just a human being. Meanwhile, the same man who calls Jesus his greatest philosopher, when governor of Texas, presided over more executions than any governor in the history of Texas, except for the new energy secretary, Rick Perry. He lasted longer in the governor's chair than Bush did. They prey on your Christianity. They prey on your forgiveness. They prey on your belief in a higher power. Let it go. Forgiveness. These are the same people who stoke your fear, who convince you there's danger out there. Stand your ground, get a gun, go to war. But for them, when they get into trouble, when Bush gets into trouble, when the people who got us into the war in Iraq, when the people who crashed our economy get into trouble, suddenly they're Christians. Christianity, patriotism. It's as old as Christianity. It's as old as religion. If you hide behind the good book or patriotism, you can get away with anything. Not just in America, anywhere in Western civilization. I happen to believe in the politics of personal destruction. I think you should pay attention to institutions, but more importantly, you got to pay attention to the people who are running those institutions, and you have to go after them. If you come to Washington, you should be prepared for destruction, your own destruction. If you're not good at your job, get out. One of the things we're learning from Donald Trump, if you look at his cabinet picks, it doesn't matter if a law is passed. It doesn't matter if there's a regulation. It doesn't matter if there's an agency set up to protect the working man, like the Department of Labor, or an agency set up to protect the environment, like the EPA. It's the human being who's running it. So we have to pay attention to these people, and we have to destroy their careers when they fail us. Donald Trump, not since Ronald Reagan have so many cabinet appointees been named to destroy the agency they're supposed to be running. They're running these agencies into the ground. He is appointing people to run labor, to run energy, to run education, to run the Environmental Protection Agency, to run the Consumer Financial Bureau, putting people in charge who are surrendering their authority to the people who they're supposed to be regulating. So I do believe in the politics of personal destruction. If you're going to destroy my institutions that we all fought for, when Betsy DeVoe goes to Washington, D.C. school and protesters block the door, good for you. Good for you. Betsy DeVoe is the new education secretary. Couldn't get into a school last week because there were protesters. They weren't arrested. They weren't arrested. They did it legally. If you're Ari Fleischer, the former press secretary to George W. Bush, who told Bill Maher to watch what he says when the ashes of 9/11 were still smoldering at the World Trade Center, Ari Fleischer said, watch what you say. When you're Bill Kristol, who founded PNAC, invented the invasion of Iraq, when you're David Frum, who worked in the Bush White House with Richard Pearl and helped dream up and promulgate the invasion of Iraq, the lie that Iraq was behind 9/11, you need to go away. When you're Henry Kissinger, who was National Security Advisor and Secretary of State under Richard Nixon, responsible for the Christmas bombings of Hanoi, the secret war in Laos, the slaughter of Suharto's opponents in East Timor. When you're Henry Kissinger, you need to go away. Kissinger and Associates doesn't get to advise the Bush administration on how to manage Iraq, which they did. It was Kissinger and Associates, who managed the occupation of Iraq under George W. Bush. F. Scott Fitzgerald said, there are no second acts in America. Mike Flynn is under fire now because, I don't have to remind you, as you all know, in December, President Obama issued sanctions against Russia for sticking their beak into our elections. Apparently, Mike Flynn met with one of Putin's underlings and assured him, don't worry, Obama was not a fan of Russia, but we'll lift those sanctions. So Flynn violated the Logan Act, which has never been enforced, by the way. The Logan Act forbids freelance diplomacy, where people go off and negotiate with other governments on behalf of the United States. It's a violation of the Logan Act. Before that, he had been fired by President Obama, and yet he got a second act. That would be nice if there were no second acts in America. There are third acts, fourth acts, fifth acts. These people do not go away. There have to be consequences for your misdeeds. General David Petraeus gave secrets to a woman he was sleeping with. He was sleeping with this woman, having an affair, which is against the law. If you're in the Army, you're not allowed to have an affair. He's a four-star general and then director of the Central Intelligence Agency. Had an affair with this woman, Paula Broadwell, because she was his biographer. He pleaded guilty April 23rd, 2015. Petraeus pleaded guilty to mishandling classified materials. He was given a two-year probationary period and had to pay a fine of about $100,000. That was in 2012. He resigned as CIA chief under President Obama. Before that, he took responsibility for the surge, the success of the surge in Iraq back in about 2007, and claimed we needed more boots on the ground. The Bush administration hailed the surge as this great military victory, when in fact, any success that we had in Iraq during the surge was due to CIA agents and military officers walking around Sunni neighborhoods with suitcases filled with cash. They paid off the Sunni warlords. Read about this. Not to discredit our soldiers, but any success from the 2007 surge was not due to military conflict. It was due to Petraeus's plan to pay off Sunni warlords. And yet, even after all this failure, he is still speaking. He was still being considered to become defense secretary, national security advisor under Trump. He didn't get the appointment. The administration is still young. Petraeus will not go away. Nobody goes away. There have to be consequences for what you do, for the sins, the evil you commit. So when you come to Washington, D.C., you have to reveal your taxes. You have to be vetted. You cannot just be a conduit to big business, which is what everybody in the Trump administration is. They are open about it. I'm the new Secretary of State. I'm Rex Tillerson. I work for ExxonMobil. So frack away, pipelines, let's go. Betsy DeVoe, billionaire, Amway fortune, brother is Eric Prince, started Blackwater, big with the Christian schools, school vouchers. I'm the head of education. We're going to privatize education. We're going to destroy the public schools and make it a fait accompli that they can't educate our children, so school vouchers will be the way. Rick Perry, energy. Hey, big oil. Energy. Oh, I have to monitor nuclear weapons too? Oops. Mnuchin, Treasury. Father worked for Goldman Sachs. Mnuchin worked for Goldman Sachs. You think he's going to regulate Wall Street? Puzder, the CEO of the company that runs Hardee's and is against sick leave, family leave, the minimum wage. You're going to put him in charge of protecting the rights of workers? No, you come to Washington with that portfolio, you need to be destroyed legally, peacefully, but you need to be run out of town. If you're not up for the job, there are 350 million other citizens in this country who will do it and will do it right. You got to go, and you got to be punished for the crimes you commit. There have to be consequences, but in America, there are no consequences. I keep talking about Laos. America, over a decade and a half, from the air, bombed Laos, killed 10% of their population, dropped more bombs on Laos than all the bombs that were dropped on Japan and Germany combined. That includes those two atomic bombs dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. President Obama went to Laos last year and apologized for this. And by the way, the CIA's little secret war over there that went on for a decade and a half, we lost. The Pathet Lao was still in power after all was said and done. It's not even a secret. We all knew about it. We didn't care. And nobody's paid a price for that, except the Laotian people. Those cluster bombs are still going off. Cluster bombs are like landmines. They should be outlawed. Obama issued a ban on selling cluster bombs to foreign countries. But Saudi Arabia, our good friend Saudi Arabia, are lobbying the Trump administration to lift the ban on cluster bombs. They need cluster bombs. Who went to jail for the housing crash? Who went to jail for Wall Street? Dodd-Frank disappearing. The same people who gave us the Great Recession are in charge. They're in charge. Nobody went to prison. The invasion of Iraq. The one blessing from Donald Trump is he made an established law that Iraq was the biggest debacle in American history. That's like established fact. When Jeb Bush had to just stand there during the debate, I got the chills when Trump said, Iraq didn't attack us on 9/11, and your brother didn't keep us safe because 9/11 happened on his watch, and he invaded the wrong country. You know, Trump, you know, he spoke the truth. He said to Jeb Bush on national television, and people moaned, and because it was filled with Bush operatives, the debate audience was filled with Bush operatives, and they moaned and they booed, but he stood his ground and he said, the Bush administration, your brother, did not keep us safe. 9/11 happened on his watch because he ignored intelligence briefings that said Osama bin Laden intent on attacking the United States by flying planes into buildings. He ignored those. Common knowledge that he lied about Iraq being responsible for 9/11. And the invasion of Iraq was a complete debacle. Trump said that to Bush's face on national television, made that established law. People booed, and Trump just smiled and said, you know what? This audience is filled with Bush supporters. I don't care. It's the truth. And Bush slinked away. The family slinked away. That's pretty good that he did that. You know, he didn't serve in Vietnam, Trump, but you know, thank you for your service, Trump. Thank you for doing that. He should have gone away after that. You know, would have been nice if he got the nomination and Hillary won. I would love Trump. I really would. I would love Donald Trump if he had lost, if he weren't president, because he would have been responsible for the destruction of the Bush wing of the Republican Party. I don't know what happened. For the life of me, I can't figure out how 70,000 votes in three swing states miraculously were delivered, and Trump now sits in President Obama's chair. When people screw up in America, we create heroes instead of convicts. Suddenly everybody's a hero, unless you're a person of color who ran a stop sign. Then you go to prison. Rudy Giuliani became a hero after 9/11, even though he had been warned, hey, you know what? New York City is a bullseye for Al-Qaeda. There's going to be an attack. Make sure your command center is underground. But Rudy didn't listen, and he put the command center in Ground Zero, right in the center of the bullseye. So when 9/11 happened, there was no command center because Rudy Giuliani didn't listen to the people who knew about terrorism. There were police officers who couldn't communicate with firemen, and FBI couldn't communicate with the local police because Rudy didn't listen. Rudy put the terrorist command center in the spot that had already been attacked in 1993 by terrorists. You don't put your terrorist command center in the spot where you're going to be attacked. But that day, he was a hero. And everybody became a hero. Nobody made any mistakes. The minute 9/11 happened, frame the narrative, Rudy's a hero. Look how he's keeping everybody calm. George Bush, don't point fingers. After Pearl Harbor, there were investigations into how it happened, and admirals were fired. Because back then, when you put our young boys and girls into harm's way, you better be competent. Now we don't have a draft. So if you volunteer for the military, you're automatically a hero. If you're a general, you're a hero. And you can't question heroes, because that's unpatriotic. So they get away with literally murder. Rudy Giuliani hides behind the firemen, hides behind the police. If you question me, you're questioning our police. You're questioning the heroes. And then he waves the Bible at everybody, like red meat. And everybody goes, oh, he's a Christian. We'll forgive him. Let's say, well, why look into, we shouldn't investigate Rudy. We shouldn't investigate George W. Bush for 9/11, why he screwed up, why Osama bin Laden's entire family on 9/11 was allowed to fly back to Saudi Arabia. We won't look into that because George W. Bush is a Christian. He's a hero. You can screw up in America big time. You can have blood on your hands. You can be Ari Fleischer, Bill Kristol, David Frum, Henry Kissinger, Dick Cheney, Paul Wolfowitz. You can have blood on your hands, and as long as it's red, the same color as the Republican Party, and you color within the lines, you're fine. I believe in shaming people. Not my children. Not the people I love. But I do believe in time out, which is a form of shame. When your kids are young, don't hit them. Don't berate them. You give them a timeout. And that's a form of shame. Timeout says, we're a community. And as animals, we like to be around other people. You are being antisocial. This behavior is antisocial. It's not good for the community. Go away. Timeout. Did you learn your lesson? Okay, you can come back in. That's how you socialize a child. And we need to do that with the people who run our government, the people who run our corporations. They need serious timeouts. Some people need a permanent timeout. And I'm not for capital punishment. I'm saying if you're Ari Fleischer, if you're George W. Bush, if you're Dick Cheney, if you're David Frum, Elliot Abrams, Henry Kissinger, you get a permanent timeout. Prison? You know, Elliot Abrams, I'll talk about Elliot Abrams in a second. He was pardoned by George Herbert Walker Bush. I'll get to Elliot Abrams later. He's still popping up as a possible national security advisor to Donald Trump. No consequences. If you're white, educated, and willing to suck up to the people in your party, Democrat or Republican, there are enough forces behind you with money and influence who will keep you out of prison and make sure there's some redemption for you. I believe in shame. These people should be ashamed of themselves, but we're now a shameless society, and it's getting worse. Dick pics, Anthony Weiner. You get caught sending dick pics as a congressman, you go away. That's it. You're done. Now, he runs for mayor. Sex tapes. People see nothing wrong with filming themselves having sex, sending dick pics. I see nothing wrong with it. We're no longer private. Virtually naked now. Facebook, this is all cliche. We all know this. But we expose everything about ourselves on Facebook. What we like, what we dislike. There are pictures that we post that are part of our permanent record, being drunk, doing God knows what. Who cares? Put it up. There are no consequences because we're shameless. In many ways, that's good. in many ways, that's good. There was a time when a man who was divorced three times could not get elected president. I remember Gerald Ford taking over for Richard Nixon, and there were some people who clutched their pearls because Betty Ford, his wife, had been married before. And people going, oh my, she was divorced. That was back in 1974, not that long ago. Well, now anybody, and I do mean anybody, can be president. Maybe we should go back to people being a bit appalled. We need a little more shame in this country. When people tell me the NSA is probably listening in on my phone calls, I go, good, more followers. Maybe I'm being entertaining. They'll listen to my podcast. So this is not Nazi Germany. I would calm down. As they said right after Chernobyl, it'll blow over. This is not Nazi Germany. We are not going to become a totalitarian state. We are going to become what we already are. Don't flatter yourself, America. I keep saying this to my friends. Stop flattering yourself by crying about Donald Trump. We've lost our innocence. No, he's just ugly. He says things ugly. This is partly who we are and who we've always been. It's not going to be Nazi Germany. It's going to be the United States. It's going to be the United States that always was a great country, the greatest country in the history of civilization, a country that saved my family. My family would be dead if it weren't for America. And a country that has done horrible, horrible things. And it will continue to be this way. We will always be this way. There will always be this tension between good and evil in America. That's who we are. I'm a space nut. I'm obsessed with Apollo 11. Look at the Saturn V rocket, the three-stage rocket, liquid fuel, that shot a man, yes, a man, to the moon. The Saturn V, who developed that? Well, we wouldn't have done it if it weren't for the Nazis. Wernher von Braun, we took a lot of Nazis. We got the atomic bomb from Hitler, but only because Hitler was persecuting Jews, and the Jews like Einstein left and came to America and said, here's what we've been doing in Germany. You better hurry up and make this atomic bomb before the Nazis figure it out. After World War II, right at the end, the rocket scientists, people like Wernher von Braun, who developed the V2, this was a liquid fuel rocket, that ballistic, that was launched into England. It was the first time rockets had ever been used. America did not have rockets during World War II. Hitler had them. Had he not invaded Russia, he would have destroyed England with his V2s. So after the war, the Nazi rocket scientists had a choice. They could either go work for Stalin or they could go work for Truman. And they said, you know what? We should go to America. And we brought all these Nazis to America to build rockets. You're a Nazi, not so bad. I call them not so Nazis. They, you know what? They say there are no second acts in America. We got to change that. Forget your past. Build us some rockets. Actually, when I was growing up, I grew up with Holocaust survivors, and smack dab in the middle was this German guy who had a telescope. He would invite us all over to look at the moon in his telescope, and he had this job making lenses in New York City. I don't want to give his name out, but it became very apparent to me after I moved out of New Jersey that they redlined the neighborhoods. My father couldn't buy in certain parts. My father served in World War II and then the GI Bill. And then, you know, if you served in World War II, you'd get a loan from the government to buy a home. And you'd go to a bank, and my father's last name, Feldman. And he was only shown houses in New Jersey where there were other Jews. They controlled neighborhoods. I was surrounded by the children of Holocaust survivors, and smack dab in the middle of all these Holocaust survivors was a house, and there was a guy there who, with a thick German accent, who would invite us over to look at the moon on his telescope. He had this big fancy telescope, and he was big with lenses, and he had these sons who looked like the Hitler Youth Eugenics program. There was a lot of tension growing up on my street, needless to say. Looking back, I now realize that they created a pocket of Jews. These homes were sold to Holocaust survivors who all wanted to be next to each other. My father was kind of pushed into buying here. And somebody put this German guy smack dab in the middle. Some guy with probably a nefarious past. The Holocaust survivors kept an eye on him. I don't think that was accidental. I don't believe in conspiracy theories, but I find it highly suspicious that this guy was literally surrounded. His house, and then there were four houses around his house occupied by Holocaust survivors. Some of these Holocaust survivors were, part of the Polish underground. You want me to make a Polish underground joke? I'm not going to do it. The Polish underground. It was an airplane. I'm a bad guy. So after World War II, we had these Nazis making the Saturn V to launch man into outer space. It is the same Saturn V that delivers nuclear weapons. You know that capsule where Neil, Buzz, and Mike Collins sat on their way to the moon? You switch that out and put uranium in there. It's a nuclear bomb. That's the only difference. You swap out Neil Armstrong and put uranium in there. It's a nuclear bomb. And that's what America is. That's exactly what America is. We are this Saturn V rocket. What we put in that tiny little capsule on top of the Saturn V determines how good we are or how evil we are. We can put in that capsule three heroes and send them to the moon and safely return them. Or we can put uranium in there and we can destroy the world. That's who America is. Never before in the history of mankind has there been a country like America. We're pretty amazing. I say don't flatter yourself by going, oh my God, Trump, oh my God. Wake up. Don't flatter yourself. We've always been this way. But when you compare America to Nazi Germany, don't insult yourself, America. You're selling yourself short. We are capable of far more evil. With the press of a button, we are capable of far more evil. Capable of far more evil. We haven't committed the evil that Nazi Germany committed, as long as you're not an African American or a Native American. We're not as evil as Nazi Germany. The Oval Office is the top of the Saturn V. And we had Neil Armstrong sitting in there for 8 years, Barack Obama, greatest president of my lifetime. He was sitting in the command module for 8 years. Now we have a high-density radioactive isotope ready to blow. We will never be a totalitarian regime. We have 50 states. We're 3,141 counties. I don't know how many cities we are, but each state has its own National Guard. Each county has their sheriff, their police department. Every city has their own police department. We have a Second Amendment, which we should get rid of. But we have independent militia. It's very hard for somebody sitting in the Oval Office to create a totalitarian state. because we are a hodgepodge. We will never march in lockstep. Never. And we shouldn't, because when everybody's on the same page, when we're all united, that's a bad thing. Division is good. The adversarial approach to government is a good thing. So good luck trying to create a totalitarian state in this country. We are countries within countries, nations within nations, kind of like the system we set up with Native Americans, all these independent reservations and their independent countries. That's basically what we're becoming. Stop saying there's a red state and blue state divide. If you don't live in a city, you live in your own country. The only thing that affects you is what you see on television, for the most part. If you're a person of color, if you're undocumented, your life is hell. Your life is absolute hell. But if you're white, you're in your own narcissistic vortex, dealing with your own identity crisis and your own needs, which is what our politicians in Washington, D.C. prey on. They prey on the hope that you're only going to care about, I'm Jewish, I only care about Israel. I'm gay, I only care about gay rights. I'm black, I only care about Black Lives Matter. I'm a woman, I only care about abortion. That's a problem in this country where we aren't united in our struggle. We're countries within countries. We're able to wall ourselves off from the world with our own identity issues. The one thing that would unite us, but I get pushback on this, is Medicare for all. 99%. I'm told that's not the answer by some people. I'm told that you can't have Medicare for all until you deal with abortion. You can't have Medicare for all until you address Black Lives Matters, because doctors treat African Americans differently than they do white people. So unless you address systemic racism in this country, you can't have Medicare for all. I'm kind of like Trump. I'm kind of like George W. Bush. It's too complicated. I do a gut check. Let's bottom line this. Medicare for all. Let's all unite on one thing. Medicare for all. If I were put in charge, I'd be as bad as Trump and the Republicans, because I believe that the Republicans are united by one thing, money and hatred. They can all get behind that. I want money, and I hate people. Give me money. So we should take a page from the Republicans. Hatred, that's a good motivator. Money. I hate the rich. I hate corporations. I want to distribute their wealth through taxation. And I want universal health care. Money. Hatred and money. That's what motivates the Republicans. We should be motivated by the same thing. Hatred and money. Jobs. Why do 40 families control 70% of the wealth in America? I hate them. I hate them. I want their money. The same way those families hate us and want our money. They want us to work for free. Let's just take the Republican playbook. We are, in many ways, the Tea Party. We are, our side is as active now, as disruptive now at the town hall meetings, as disruptive as the Tea Party was back in 2010, fighting Obamacare. You know, if you look at the ideology of the political parties, they're coiled snakes. You all know this, that people think they're smart when they say, Donald Trump is such a racist. I haven't heard such racism since the Democrats before the Civil War. Well, yeah, the Democrats were a racist party during the Civil War. They changed. They were a coalition of Southern racists and abolitionists in the North, but the Republican Party really was the party of the abolitionists up until Lyndon Johnson, and then it changed. And now the Republican Party is the old Confederacy. Same name, different product. They rebranded themselves. The Republican Party became the Democratic Party, and the Republican Party became the old Confederacy. The Republicans went from the party of Jefferson to the party of Jefferson Davis. And what's happening now, because God has a sense of humor, is Democrats are suddenly discovering states' rights. There was a time when we opposed, the Democrats hated states' rights, because that was the cudgel that Republicans have always used to block black people from voting, to block black people from being absorbed into our culture, states' rights. It's up to the individual states to decide. The 10th Amendment, powers revert back to the states. When you have an activist government in Washington, D.C., you don't like states' rights. Well, suddenly there's a groundswell of blue states' rights in America. California, Illinois, New York, big and blue, like my balls after my wife asked me for a divorce, big and blue. And they're fighting back, and they are literally trolling Trump, delegitimating him, passing bizarre legislation just to humiliate and embarrass Donald Trump, threatening to create sanctuary states for undocumented workers. Suddenly, we're discovering states' rights. The Attorney General of Washington State said on Sunday that they would fight any executive order issued by Donald Trump that violates the Constitution. His name is Bob Ferguson. He's the Attorney General of Washington. He was on ABC's George Stephanopoulos. He said that the travel ban from seven majority Muslim countries is unconstitutional. And he said, we'll fight it. Whatever they come up with that violates the Constitution, whatever's unlawful, my job as Attorney General of the state of Washington is to make sure that everyone in the country, even Trump, upholds the Constitution. There was an article in Politico by Natasha Korecki. It came out Monday, entitled States Find New Ways to Troll Trump. She says that lawmakers, Democratic lawmakers at the state level, are getting creative in finding ways not just to protect their states from Trump's executive orders, but also to just piss Trump off, which is the right thing to do. Hot-tempered. Sun Tzu talks about this. If your opponent is hot-tempered, keep poking at him. One California lawmaker is demanding that Melania Trump's immigration records be unsealed. In New Hampshire, they've introduced legislation demanding a federal probe into Trump University. In Illinois, they're calling for an investigation into Russia's interference in the presidential election of 2016. There's also a draft that hasn't been passed yet, but there's a draft of an invitation to the president of Mexico to invite him to address their chambers. Several states are trying to block Donald Trump from their ballots unless he discloses his taxes. And other states, and I love this, are writing bills that would disenfranchise any company that goes along with Donald Trump's policies that are unconstitutional or that they disapprove of. For example, if you are a contractor participating in the building of the wall, then the states say they will not do business with you, which is perfectly legal. Some legislatures are proposing bills to make sure that pension funds for state workers divest themselves of any holdings in companies that help construct the border wall. Illinois, New Mexico, and California, those are Democrat-majority states. They haven't passed these laws yet, but they are considering laws that would require, if you want to be on the ballot in their state, you have to reveal your federal income tax records. There's no federal ballot. They're all state ballots, which is why fixing an election in the United States is more complicated. It's done, but you got to do it city by city, state by state. That's what makes America great. It's hard to fix a national election. The only way you can fix it is by swaying public opinion. The best way to fix an election is to sway public opinion, to have Comey come out right before the election and say, you know what, we're investigating Hillary again, or have Putin reveal embarrassing secrets about Hillary, but not reveal the embarrassing secrets they have about Donald Trump. That's how you can fix an election, because it's very hard to get each county, each state, not to count the votes right. It's done all the time. I have no doubt that they're able to tap into the people counting ballots. But it's, as I said earlier, there are 3,141 counties, what, 15,000 cities in America, 20,000 cities in America. Then there are individual precincts. Pretty hard to fix a national election. So the Democrats are discovering states' rights. And what does that mean for you, the listener? It means you can think globally, but act locally. That will alleviate the paralysis that you feel. Turn off your TV. The things that are going on in Washington, sound and fury. All you can do is change what you see in front of you. You have a mayor. You have a congressperson. You have a state senator. You have a state assembly person. Fix what's in front of you. Get a broom and start sweeping. Mental health comes from mindfulness, concentrating, focusing, drilling down to what's right in front of you. When you're cutting a tomato, when you're stir-frying tofu, focus on the tofu and the vegetables. When you're trying to fix the world, fix what's in front of you. Michael Jackson, I'm staring at the man in the mirror, and I see a little boy. Go local. Eat local. Support local businesses. Support local farmers. Support your local politicians. It'll bubble up. It'll bubble up to Washington. CNN, MSNBC, Fox, they're not covering your city. You know who else isn't covering your city? Your local newspaper, your local radio station, your local television station, because they're owned and operated by Washington, D.C. They're owned and operated by like five corporations. So they're not going to cover your city. They're not going to cover your county or your state. Do you know the number of reporters who cover your state legislature? It's like a handful of full-time reporters who cover your state legislature. Why? Because all the newspapers were bought up by five or six corporations, because radio stations are owned by five or six corporations. Television stations are owned by five or six corporations. What is in the interest of Comcast? Why would they want reporters covering state legislatures? Why would they want a well-informed citizenry monitoring their every move? You have to rely on legitimate news sources on the web. There are websites that cover your state legislatures, that cover your municipalities. But you got to work and find them. In terms of the tail of the comet, that's where the money is. If you're a journalist, drill down. Focus on one city. I've always thought about doing this, giving it all up, picking a city, and just covering the shit out of it. I think there's money to be made that way. Holding your mayor and your city council accountable. I think there's money to be made holding your state legislators accountable. Finding out who the lobbyists are. Who's influencing them. We're on the brink of a golden age of journalism. And my recommendation, if you're young and you want to be a journalist, go local. When I was young, everybody wanted to be Woodward and Bernstein. Woodward and Bernstein destroyed journalism. They became superstars. Those were the two guys who investigated. Richard Nixon wrote All the President's Men. Robert Redford and Dustin Hoffman played them in the movies. And I remember wanting to be a journalist, and then I saw All the President's Men. I thought, no, I want to be famous. I want to be a hero. Well, the job of journalism is heroic. Very few people should have their eyes set on becoming heroes. And what happened is, most young people my age gravitated to TV news because that's where the money and fame was. Nobody wanted to be a real journalist. They all got seduced by bright lights, the cameras, and the fame. Everybody became Woodward and Bernstein without having to do what Woodward and Bernstein accomplished. They got to be famous for just being famous. And now all journalism is just talking heads. You turn on MSNBC, you turn on CNN. It's just people talking. Nobody in the trenches, nobody plowing through records like ProPublica does. You just read something in the New York Times, and then they turn a camera on you, and you opine. That's what journalism has become, because we don't reward digging, research, wearing down your shoes. And because newspapers and radio stations and television stations are controlled by five corporations, you're not financially rewarded to do real journalism. Keep it light, keep it simple, keep the argument going. So turn off your effing television. You're not being informed. You know who watches, who keeps the TV going all day? You know who keeps CNN going all day? Donald Trump. There's your cautionary tale of what happens when you have CNN going all day. You're left ignorant, angry, and confused, just like Donald Trump. There was a time when you could come back, but you had to do a serious mea culpa. You know, Richard Nixon had to resign, and then he paid what many presidents would consider the ultimate price, humiliation. And then there was a little redemption afterwards. He did those interviews with David Frost. Many people feel he suffered enough. He actually garnered sympathy because he was a broken man, and he lived the rest of his life kind of admitting that he did something illegal. He wrote books, and he was a pathetic figure. But things changed after that. Things changed after Watergate. Suddenly, there was no mea culpa. Reagan, when Contragate came around, that's when personal responsibility ended. Ronald Reagan came to office with a vision of a new America where it was personal responsibility. Forget the government, forget welfare. Everybody's responsible for their own actions, unless I screw up. And Reagan screwed up big time. Contragate. There were hostages being held in Lebanon and Syria. Some of them were CIA agents. President Reagan wanted them released. They were being held by Hezbollah, by Iranian surrogates operating in Lebanon and Syria. Bud McFarlane flew to Iran. He had the Israelis contact Iran. Bud McFarlane, who was the national security advisor at the time, flew to Iran to make a deal to trade arms for hostages. This was the deal. They were going to secretly, through Israeli intermediaries, sell arms to the Iranians. And in exchange, the Iranians would release the hostages being held in Lebanon and Syria. The arms were delivered to the Iranians. Some of the hostages were released. This was all orchestrated by Bud McFarlane, who tried to kill himself after this was revealed, and Colonel Oliver North. The Iranians paid $30 million for the arms. The arms for hostage deal got revealed in a Lebanese newspaper, and then it spread throughout the world, and the Reagan administration had to either tell the truth or deny whether or not they sold arms for hostages. And they admitted that they sold arms for hostages. An investigation conducted by Reagan's Attorney General Edwin Meese discovered that Colonel Oliver North got $30 million for the sale of the weapons, but only deposited $12 million into the Treasury. That left $18 million unaccounted for. We soon discovered that Oliver North, supposedly working all by himself, gave the $18 million to the Contras. These were the freedom fighters who were trying to overthrow the Sandinistas in Nicaragua. Daniel Ortega had overthrown Somoza during the Carter administration. Somoza was a fascist general, pro-American. The Sandinistas led by Daniel Ortega, who is still the leader of Nicaragua, was an avowed Marxist. General Somoza's regime went into exile in Honduras. They wanted their money. They wanted their land back. They wanted their power back. They were called the Contras. They were fighting a guerrilla war to reclaim Nicaragua from the Sandinistas. Ronald Reagan compared the Contras to George Washington and believed they were as noble as our founding fathers. They probably, given who George Washington and Thomas Jefferson were, they probably were on par with the Contras, brutal slaveholders out for themselves. So suddenly there was $18 million being given to the Contras. It was a secret CIA deal that Oliver North orchestrated, and this became known as Iran-Contra. Iran, the money from Iran, went to the Contras, who were trying to overthrow the Sandinistas in Nicaragua. And just like in Laos, this was a CIA secret war using federal money, this time in violation of the Boland Amendment. Congress had passed the Boland Amendment before all this, which specifically forbade the president from aiding the Contras. The democratically controlled House wanted a hands-off policy when it came to Nicaragua. They did not want the Somoza regime reinstalled. Congress controls the purse strings. They passed the Boland Amendment that said you cannot spend money arming the Contras. So Colonel Oliver North, working in the White House, came up with this workaround. Sell arms to the Iranians, release the hostages, get $30 million, $12 million we'll deposit into the Treasury, we'll keep $18 million and give that to the Contras. And when that got exposed, that became known as the Iran-Contra affair. Far worse than anything Nixon did. Nixon had to resign for Watergate. This was far worse than anything Nixon ever did. Reagan should have been impeached. There were the Iran-Contra hearings, and that is when Washington, D.C. stared into the abyss. Congress considered their investigative mandate and said, nah, we're not going to go there. This is too dangerous. In fact, Arthur Lyman, his son is a movie director now, Arthur Lyman was the chief counsel to the Contragate Committee, and he gave an interview later. And he said, you know, we could have impeached. We could have recommended that Reagan get impeached. He had violated the Boland Amendment. He had violated separation of powers. He had lied to the American people. He traded arms for hostage in direct violation of all foreign policy protocols. This was a slam dunk for impeachment. Arthur Lyman, Democrat, Wall Street lawyer, went down to D.C., to be the special counsel on the Contragate Committee. He gave an interview afterwards and said, we decided not to pursue impeachment because we didn't think it would be good for America. 1987, we were close to an arms deal with Gorbachev. We didn't want to jeopardize this. And on the heels of Richard Nixon, we didn't think as Democrats it would be right to force another Republican president to resign. He gave that interview. So Reagan survived. He went on national television to issue an apology. This is when suddenly Americans had second acts, third acts, fourth acts. If you were white, male, and in power, you could be forgiven for anything. Reagan went on national television to apologize. He said, now, what should happen when you make a mistake is this. You take your knocks, you learn your lessons, and then you move on. You take your knocks, you learn your lessons, and then you move on. Meanwhile, he's fighting a massive drug war, locking up black men for crack who are taking their knocks, learning their lessons, and they're moving on to prison. But not Oliver North. Oliver North ends up getting off on a technicality. There was no question that Oliver North was guilty. He ended up running for Senate in Virginia losing, being hired by Fox News, being taken care of by the Republicans, given a radio show. He never went away. This is the excuse that Reagan gave. This is what he said to the American people, and we forgave him. And Arthur Lyman decided not to recommend impeachment. Reagan said, "A few months ago, I told the American people I did not trade arms for hostages. My heart and my best intentions still tell me that's true, but the facts and the evidence tell me it's not." And everybody said, well, his heart and his best intentions are telling him that he didn't lie to the American people. So let's forgive him, because that's what's best for the country. To this day, we have Kellyanne Conway saying, don't pay attention to what Trump says. Pay attention to what's in his heart. This comes from Reagan, where we begin to hold these criminals to a different standard. Don't judge Reagan by what he's done. Judge by what's in his heart. At this time, he also had Alzheimer's disease. And that was the other dirty, dark secret that nobody wanted to reveal, that the president was a complete basket case. But they kept him in the Oval Office anyway, because what better way to loot the government than to have somebody who's got Alzheimer's sitting in the Oval Office? Do you really think, when we hear reports, Al Franken was saying Republicans are concerned that Trump is crazy? Do you really think the people who installed Donald Trump don't know that already? They want a crazy guy in the Oval Office. They don't want somebody paying attention, going over the books. So we let Reagan slide for Contrigate. And by letting Reagan slide, Congress slide. It no longer became an investigative arm in Washington. We decided as a people never to make a president resign for a crime. A blowjob, maybe, but not for a real crime, because it wouldn't be good for the country. I think impeachment's great for the country. So we chose not to investigate that. A guy named Lawrence Walsh investigated the affair for 8 years, and 14 people were charged with a cover-up. When George Herbert Walker Bush left office, and he had been implicated in Contrigate, former head of the CIA. When he left office, he issued 6 pardons, one to McFarlane, who tried to commit suicide and had been convicted, and one to Caspar Weinberger, who was Secretary of Defense under Reagan, and he got pardoned before his trial. Elliot Abrams also pardoned when George Herbert Walker Bush left office. Unlike Oliver North, Elliot Abrams was convicted of withholding information from Congress about the Iran-Contra affair while he was working for Reagan. He was Reagan's Assistant Secretary of State for Human Rights and Humanitarian Affairs in the early 80s. You know, this whole thing of denuding agencies by putting people who hate those agencies in charge, it all started really under Reagan. One of the first things Reagan did when he was elected president, made Elliot Abrams Assistant Secretary of State for Human Rights and Humanitarian Affairs. And Elliot Abrams was not interested in humanitarian rights. He was constantly being criticized by Amnesty International over Reagan's policies of supporting fascist regimes in El Salvador, Honduras, Guatemala, and of course the rebel Contras in Nicaragua. During the Iran-Contra investigation, the special prosecutor, Lawrence Walsh, was about to indict Elliot Abrams, but instead Abrams cooperated, plea bargained, admitted guilt to 2 misdemeanors of withholding information from Congress. He had to pay a $50 fine. He was put on probation for 2 years and had to perform 100 hours of community service. He was guilty of lying to Congress. He was then publicly censured in 1997 by the D.C. Court of Appeals for giving false testimony before Congress. But George Herbert Walker Bush pardoned him. Even though he's a convicted criminal, he worked for George W. Bush. He helped orchestrate the attempted coup against Hugo Chavez in 2002 when he was working over at the State Department. Rex Tillerson, the new Secretary of State, wanted him to take a job as Deputy Secretary of State, but Trump said no, he would not allow that. Not because of Elliot Abrams' history of supporting fascist regimes in Central America, not because he was convicted of lying before Congress when they asked about Contragate. No, it was all personal. Elliot Abrams was against Trump in the primaries, so he wasn't welcome into the State Department. But Elliot Abrams, still kicking, he married into the Podoritz family, a family of neoconservatives. Anyway, back to Contragate. They said it would be bad for the country, let it slide. And we let it slide. And George Herbert Walker Bush pardoned everybody. We let it slide. The same way we let the October surprise of 1980 slide. We're hearing a lot of talk about Mike Flynn. Everybody's upset that he violated the Logan Act because he met with a Russian ambassador after Trump was elected. And he said to the Russian ambassador, and this was on tape because the Russian ambassador, all his calls are taped. Flynn told the Russian ambassador, don't worry about the sanctions that President Obama has placed on Russia. You know, we know he's punishing you for sticking your nose into the election. But once President-elect Trump takes office, those sanctions will be withdrawn. Relax. Everybody's up in arms over this, saying, oh, my God, he violated the Logan Act. He's got to go. He lied to poor Mike Pence and told him he didn't tell the Russian ambassador that. I don't see what the big deal is because, yeah, he was negotiating with the Russians, but Trump had already been elected president. It was like 2 months away from taking office. Reagan, on the other hand, I recommend you read this book by Gary Sick or watch the Frontline documentary that's kind of based on Gary Sick's book. Gary Sick is an American professor and specialized in Iran. He served on the U.S. National Security Council under Presidents Ford and Carter, and briefly under Reagan. And he's written three books, one of which is the October Surprise Conspiracy. And there's a frontline examination that was done in 1991. I'll post it on my website. There is very convincing evidence that Bill Casey, one of the founders of the CIA, ended up becoming Reagan's CIA director. There is very convincing evidence that Bill Casey went to Paris to meet with representatives from the Revolutionary Guard holding the hostages in Iran, saying, if you hold off till after the election, you will get some weapons. You will be treated very favorably. If you do not release the hostages until after the election, after Reagan becomes president, we will be very kind to you and we will sell you the weapons you need to fight Iraq. I recommend you watch the documentary. Nobody ever looked into that because just like Contragate, and it is related to Contragate, because we ended up selling arms to the Iranians in exchange for the hostages being released. These were different hostages. These were some of the hostages being held in Lebanon. President Reagan was elected. Some suggest, Gary Sick and Frontline suggest, that Reagan's election was predicated on an Iranian arms for hostage deal. Do not release the hostages until Reagan is president, and you will get arms to fight Iraq. And it seemed really remarkable that 20 minutes after Ronald Reagan was done with his inaugural address, the hostages were released. Seemed like more than a coincidence. Seemed very strange that Iran would release the hostages 20 minutes after Ronald Reagan delivered his inaugural speech. Why do you think the Iranians chose to do it that way? Nobody looked into that. Because once you look into that, you're looking into the entire premise of democracy. It's the same way nobody really wanted to look into the Kennedy assassination. This is not new. In 1968, Richard Nixon was running against Hubert Humphrey. We were bombing North Vietnam. Nixon was worried that Johnson, by bombing North Vietnam, was going to bring the North Vietnamese to the table in Paris where they were negotiating and get them to cut a deal, which would end the war in Vietnam. Nixon was running against Humphrey. Humphrey was Johnson's vice president. The race was tightening. And the more it became apparent that the bombing was bringing North Vietnam to the table to make a deal, the more frightened Nixon became that he was going to lose the election, because if the Vietnam War ended before the election, Humphrey would win. It is now established fact that this happened. It's underreported because it was, what, almost 50 years ago? Nobody cares. This was a rumor that turned out to be true. Henry Kissinger, who was working for Nelson Rockefeller at the time, but then once Rockefeller didn't get the nomination, he began to advise Nixon. Kissinger flew to Paris in violation of the Logan Act. Nixon was using a woman named Anna, I think it's pronounced Chenot or Chenot. She was Chinese, but she was married to some American bigwig. She was the conduit to the North Vietnamese. And through Kissinger, Anna Chenot, they said to Chu, who was the president of South Vietnam, they told him not to agree to a deal at the Paris peace talks because you'll get a better deal under Nixon. Let me make this clear here. Nixon, through Kissinger and Anna Chenot, made contact with President Chu of South Vietnam before Nixon was president, and they said to him, don't sign any deals with Ho Chi Minh, with North Vietnam, because once we're president, once we're in charge, you'll get a much better deal from Nixon. And sure enough, Chu, before the election, didn't even show up for the peace conference. There are now at LBJ Library tapes of Lyndon Baines Johnson, who was president at the time, infuriated that Chu didn't show up for the peace talks, infuriated that Nixon's people, Kissinger, made a deal. He said, this is treason. These are on White House tapes from the Johnson administration. Walt Rostow, who was an aide to Lyndon Johnson, was told by Johnson to bury those tapes and the transcripts. Nobody should see them because it wouldn't be good for the country. Johnson knew that Nixon and Kissinger had committed treason by negotiating with the president of South Vietnam, telling him, don't accept the deal, stay away from the peace talks, you'll get a better deal if we're elected president. That's treason. This was before the election, and Lyndon Johnson didn't want this released. So those tapes are sitting, according to The Nation magazine, those tapes are sitting in the Lyndon Johnson library, and they are sealed. And only a couple of people have seen them. And it's incontrovertible evidence that what was once a rumor that Nixon and Kissinger made a deal before the election, it's now true. It's now true that Nixon and Kissinger told the South Vietnamese, don't make peace because we're going to win and you'll get a better deal. And because they didn't make peace, Humphrey lost. Treason. So when you talk about Mike Flynn talking to the Russian ambassador after the election, that's nothing compared to what Nixon did before he was elected president. It's nothing compared to what Reagan did with the Iranians before he was elected president. This thing with Mike Flynn after Trump was elected but not taking office pales in comparison to what Reagan and Nixon did. But thankfully, everybody's out to get Trump. So I see this as good news. I think the overreaction, I think it's an overreaction because Republicans and the Democrats want to humiliate and paralyze Trump. So it's a good thing. That's good news. There's a YouTube version of that Frontline documentary about Reagan stealing that election back in 1980. This documentary came out in 1991 and includes interviews with Gary Sick, and I'll post that on my website. I also want to thank Frank V. He sent me a YouTube video of a documentary. It's 1 hour. It's about the CIA's covert war in Laos. That's also on my website. Back to people who won't go away. There's a 56-year-old man, former New York police officer. He was chairman of the Trump campaign's Florida Law Enforcement Coalition. His name is Vincent Caldera, and he was a pilot for Eastern Airlines during the campaign and flew Donald Trump's vice presidential candidate, Mike Pence, from city to city, state to state. The Guardian came out with an article exposing Vincent Caldera. It turns out he had a history of violence. Pled guilty after he was charged with battery in Broward County, Florida, for driving his car into a former friend and business associate, a guy named Jeff Shanley. When I say drove his car, it was a 2002 Ford Crown Victoria. Those are great cars. Figures a New York City police officer would drive one of those. Caldera was driving his 2002 Ford Crown Victoria into his friend Shanley over and over again, like Richie driving over Beansy in The Sopranos. His friend underwent two surgeries. He required a spinal stimulator and a bone fusion of his right hand, which he is unable to bend. And it took place in Florida, where Beansy ends up in The Sopranos, by the way. Remember? In a separate case, and this is still active in the civil courts, Caldera is accused of severely injuring a female friend by driving his Harley-Davidson motorcycle into her. This happened in June 2014, and the woman is suing Caldera for the injuries. We're still waiting for that trial to take place. So when that story got released, former police officer Vincent Caldera was fired from the Trump campaign. Well, guess who showed up in Mar-a-Lago last weekend? None other than Vincent Caldera. He has been rehired by the Trump people to do security in Florida for Donald Trump. He posted on Facebook, "Welcome home, Mr. President. Thank you for the weekend invitation. My team and I will keep you secure." Then he posted on Facebook shortly before Trump started playing golf with Abe. He writes, "Mr. President, we got you covered." Why is this guy doing Trump's security? Why isn't the Secret Service protecting Donald Trump? Why does Donald Trump have his own security? You know who had his own security? Adolf Hitler, the SS. And somebody like Vincent Caldera was exactly the kind of sociopath that Adolf Hitler surrounded himself with for protection. I'm done with Godwin's Law. Godwin's Law says you lose your argument when you compare anybody to Hitler. One of my listeners, I think his name is Chris Fish, posted on my Facebook page, "Godwin's dead." It's a famous Time magazine cover that said God's dead in the 60s. Godwin's dead. That's a brilliant, brilliant line. What he's saying is Godwin's Law is now dead. When you have people like Vincent Caldera, former police officers who are allegedly running their Harley Davidson into women, when they're driving their cars into friends and causing spinal injuries, when you have people like this protecting the president, that begets fascism. So we have to get rid of Trump, and I'm very optimistic. I know a lot of people are scared, but I'm not. I think there are signs that the Trump administration is imploding. Rens Priebus, his chief of staff, they say he's about to get fired. People are openly attacking each other in the White House. Over the weekend, one of Trump's friends who runs Newsmax gave an interview on television saying that Rance Priebus is way over his head, not equipped to deal with Steve Bannon to run the White House. Didn't back off. Never apologized. You know, usually when the friend of a president gives an interview like that, they're counseled to take it back. Nope. The head of Newsmax then said, you know, I got a call from Rance Priebus. He begged me to give him a chance. So we'll see. That's what he said. We'll see. These are desperate people, desperately incompetent people who are going to self-destruct. I'm very optimistic. I think a lot of people are suffering right now. But in the broad sweep of history, I'm optimistic that there are still institutions in place, still bitter jealousy, that will end up getting Donald Trump removed. Kmart has dropped Ivanka. Sears has dropped Ivanka. Neiman Marcus has dropped Ivanka's stuff. Nordstrom. Sorry, Ivanka, but these days America just isn't buying your dad's shit, which means we're not buying yours. I am shocked and appalled that people all over the world, every day at 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, are pausing for 30 seconds to pray that Trump has a massive stroke. I don't approve of this, and it's not happening, but I think we need to get that going every day at 5 o'clock Eastern Standard Time, where we all pause for 30 seconds to pray that Donald Trump has a massive stroke. Everybody should start doing that so I can be appalled by it, because I don't support it. You know who W.E. Du Bois is? I don't know if I'm pronouncing it properly. It's W.E.B. Du Bois, right? On the Twitter feed, our new Secretary of Education, they misspelled Du Bois. I'm amazed that Betsy DeVoe even knows how to spell W.E.B. Back to people like Elliot Abrams won't go away. I follow Ari Fleischer on my D. Murphy Twitter account. I'm D. Murphy. I'm a woman who retired stockbroker. I wear lipstick and a wig whenever I tweet as D. Murphy. I follow all the people I can't stand as D. Murphy and occasionally waste time trolling these people. I follow Ari Fleischer. He was the former press secretary to George W. Bush. He was the one who sold the war in Iraq. He was the one who sold the notion that Iraq was behind 9/11. When Bill Maher was about to get fired from Politically Incorrect because he said that people who fly planes into buildings aren't cowards, Ari Fleischer responded, after 9/11, we all need to watch what we say. And everybody watched what they said, except Bill and a couple of patriots. But after 9/11, people shut up. I do think the Bush administration has inoculated us. I think this is why so many people are standing up. The memory is still too fresh. The lie is seared in our brains. We remember what presidents do, and I think that's why I'm optimistic we're standing up, speaking out. But Ari Fleischer won't go away because, you know, he's still young. He has to work. He has to make a living. There's never been any mea culpa. He's been taken care of by the Bush family. He's been getting jobs, doing promotions for sports companies. And occasionally he pops up on CNN and Fox News and opines. So I follow him on Twitter and I see a tweet of his. It says, you must be kidding. Please click on the link of demandprotest.com. It's protesters for hire, whatever their cause. And when I found this, it had about 500 retweets, and everybody went to demandprotest.com. And if you go to demandprotest.com, it's a website that says, we assemble movements. From grassroots organizations to advocacy groups, we seed the narratives and gather the audience you desire. When your strategy demands paid protest, we organize and bring it to life. Do you need me to go to Snopes to look that up? I did, just to double check. I went, Ari Fleischer said, go to demandprotest.com. because, you know, that's the whole meme right now, that everybody's showing up at Jason Chaffetz's office, all these town hall meetings that are getting interrupted by people who want to keep Obamacare there. We're being told this lie that George Soros is paying these protesters, that nobody really cares that their Obamacare is about to be taken away from them. All these people are being paid, and you go to demandprotest.com and there it is. The lie about the paid protesters is there for you to see. I knew right away that this was a put on. It's a really well done website. We are strategists mobilizing millennials across the globe with seated audiences and desirable messages. With absolute discretion a top priority, our operatives create convincing scenes that become the building blocks of massive movements. When you need the appearance of outrage, we are able to deliver it at scale while keeping your reputation intact. Okay, I look at that and I say, genius, that's funny. Somebody from The Onion must have come up with that. But I better double check. It's so easy to double check. You type in demand protest, real or fake. Sure enough, Snopes said it's fake immediately. It's been debunked as fraudulent. So I tweeted to Ari Fleischer, this is fake. And a couple of other people tweeted to Ari Fleischer that it was fake. He tweeted back, very innocently tweeted back. To his credit, he didn't take his first tweet down. To his credit, it's still up there because he's shameless. He's got nothing to be ashamed of. This is the guy who, you know, fed us the lie about Iraq. 2 million dead Iraqis later, he's still spreading lies, this time about a company selling fake protesters. This was debunked weeks ago, but that didn't stop Ari Fleischer from spreading another lie. In another tweet, he admits that he was fooled. He tweets out, looks like they were kidding. I've been told by two reporters that the site is a hoax. For a hoax, it's pretty realistic. Yeah. He had to wait for two reporters to tell him it's a hoax. He didn't have the wherewithal to spend literally 10 seconds to Google demandprotest.com. But, you know, Ari tweeted it anyway, because, you know, facts never were Ari's forte. He's still tweeting. He sold us the invasion of Iraq. He still shows his face in public. No consequences in America. Certainly no consequences in the Republican Party. Basically, what an idiot, Ari Fleischer. Wouldn't you be ashamed to tweet out a lie? But that's what he was paid to do when he was working for George W. Bush. There are no consequences in America. No consequences for Ari Fleischer, no consequences for Elliot Abrams, no consequences for Ronald Reagan, no consequences for George W. Bush, no consequences for Bill Kristol. They're not paid protesters. The phones are ringing off the hook in Congress. Keep calling. We got to stay focused. You got to go after Trump. He's got to release his taxes. There's a New Jersey congressman who is invoking a 1924 law that says Congress can demand to see a president's tax returns. We need Congress to do its job. The head of the United States House Committee on Oversight and Government Reform is Jason Chaffetz or Chaffetz. I don't know. I don't watch television, so I don't know if it's pronounced Chaffetz or Chaffetz. He's got Darrell Issa's old job as head of the United States House Committee on Oversight and Government Reform. They are supposed to monitor the White House. They are the ones who are supposed to keep Donald Trump in check. Chaffetz had a town hall meeting. Constituents screamed, do your job, do your job, do your job. And of course, Ari Fleischer said that those were paid protesters. They're not. Just because a district is red, it doesn't mean there aren't liberals and Democrats in that district. There are a lot, and they're making their voices heard, and they're not being paid by George Soros, and they want Jason Chaffetz or Chaffetz to do his job. His phone number is 202-225-7751. 202-225-7751. Here's some background about Jason Chaffetz. Jason had a Jewish father and a mother who was a Christian Scientist. Before Jason's dad married Jason's mom, Jason's dad was married to a woman who now goes by the name of Mrs. Kitty Dukakis. Yes, that Kitty Dukakis. Michael Dukakis' wife. We love her. We do. We loved Michael Dukakis. He ran against George Herbert Walker Bush in 1988. He was the governor of Massachusetts. He was a good man, married to a kind woman who was deeply troubled. Alcohol. She's now a proponent of shock therapy. She suffers from what Carrie Fisher suffered from. Good woman. So Jason's dad had been married to the woman who is now Kitty Dukakis, and then they divorced, and then he married Jason's mom. Jason's mom was a Christian Scientist. Jason's dad was Jewish. Jason was raised as a Jew. After the divorce, Jason's mom went from Christian Scientist to Mormon. So Jason decided that he didn't like his father, so he converted from Judaism to Mormonism. He was a Democrat. His father was married to the future Mrs. Kitty Dukakis. But Jason decided, now that I'm a Mormon, I'm going to become a Republican. That is the congressperson who is now running the United States House Committee on Oversight and Government Reform. His phone number is 202-225-7751. You got to call him, because given this punishingly complicated history with his father, there is no way a quisling like Jason Chaffetz would ever on his own find the moral compass to investigate Donald Trump. He's got problems with his father. He needs a dad. He wasn't raised properly. Just like all the other Republican tools serving in this House, Jason's a lost soul, desperately seeking an authority figure to tell him what exactly he needs to do. Look at that family history. He's lost. That's why he loves Trump. People who love Trump are craving the authority figure they didn't have because their parents were crazy. There is no greater recipe for fascism than what we've got now in the Republican Party. This party of weak white men with daddy issues. That's what Republican politics has now degenerated to. It is now the sole province of white men with unresolved daddy issues who, like Jason Chaffetz, are too hideous to make it as male strippers. If Jason Chaffetz, with all those daddy issues, had he been a better looking guy, he'd go be a Chippendale. He'd go be with Thunder Down Under. He'd be a male stripper, but he's ugly. He's hideous. So he resolves his daddy issues by becoming a Republican. His phone number is 202-225-7751. Jason needs a real authority figure. So call him right now and tell him who his daddy is, because it's not Trump. Fascists like Trump are like child molesters in that they prey on men who either had an absentee father or a weak and ineffectual one. Men like Jason Chaffetz will follow Donald Trump into the gates of hell because they crave an authority figure. Call Jason Chaffetz. Now, I'm told that he doesn't care. I'm being told that his phone, he doesn't answer his phone now. You can write to him, send him a postcard at 51 South University Avenue, Suite 318, Provo, Utah, 84601. Jason Chaffetz, 51 South University Avenue, Suite 318, Provo, Utah, 84601.
Maz Jobrani joins us. His new special is on Netflix. It's entitled I'm Not a Terrorist, But I've Played One on TV. He's also starring in a new CBS sitcom called Superior Donuts, Monday nights at 9 p.m. He joins us in his car from Los Angeles. Hello there, Maz.
How are you, David? This is the only way to join you from Los Angeles.
In your car. And did I lose you?
No. Can you hear me?
Oh, yeah. I thought I lost you.
No, I was saying that it's a pleasure to be on. I said that since I'm calling in from L.A., the only way to be on is from a car. That's what we do out here.
And I won't do the Maserati joke because...
No.
I won't do that. I won't say, Maz, are you calling from a Maserati? I would never do that.
Yeah, so, I don't know if I'd ever buy one.
Yeah. You have a new special called I'm Not a Terrorist, But I've Played One on TV. It's on Netflix, and there's a book out, right?
Yeah, same name. I'm Not a Terrorist, But I've Played One on TV. It tells my story. You know, I was born in Iran, and I grew up in Northern California, so I came to America at the time of the Iranian Revolution of 79. Actually, I came out in late 78. Right in time for the hostage crisis so that I could be welcomed as an Iranian by all the Americans.
Right.
And so I tell the story of growing up Iranian in America. I tell stories of traveling around the world and doing stand-up. And the book is just a biography in a funny way. And then the stand-up is just me doing my stand-up. It feels like, you know, I've done a handful of stand-up comedy specials, and it always feels like I'm trying to put Americans at ease. So... My original special that I was on was the Axis of Evil Comedy Tour, which made fun of the term that the Bush administration had come up with. But then my first solo special was called Brown and Friendly. My second solo special was called I Come in Peace. And then my latest special is I'm Not a Terrorist, But I've Played One on TV. I think just trying to put Americans at ease, David.
Yes. Yeah. And on Monday nights on CBS, Superior Donuts, what is that about?
So that's based off of a play by Tracy Letts, who's a playwright and an actor, and the show stars Judd Hirsch as an older white man who owns a donut shop in Chicago, and a younger black guy played by Jermaine Fowler, who's also stand-up. Starts working at the donut shop and helps them modernize it. And then there's a cast of characters that inhabit the donut shop. They include Katie Sagal, who plays a cop. David Koechner plays one of the guys who hangs out. I play an Iraqi businessman who owns properties in the neighborhood, and I'm trying to buy the donut shop. I describe it as as Cheers meets Chico and the Man.
Well, I hope it's as successful as both. So congratulations. And are you on the Radford lot at CBS?
Yes, the Radford lot. It's been I've been on two series before, and I haven't been a regular on a series since 2006. So I've forgotten about just that life, and I've been touring as a stand-up for the past 10 years or so. So it was kind of nice to have this day job to go to. James Burroughs has been directing a lot of the episodes.
Wow.
And it's been a pretty nice gig to have. And tonight's episode is episode 3. And we'll see how the numbers do. And if the numbers do well enough, hopefully they'll have us back for another season.
Okay. This airs tomorrow. So.
I see. Okay. Yeah. So Monday. Yeah. So. I'll say...
Okay. We go live to tape. We don't edit. So if you're listening and you want to see yesterday's show, set the time machine to 12 hours and don't try to kill baby Hitler.
They could go to CBS.com on the CBS.com app and they could watch all the episodes and catch up.
Oh, can you kill baby Hitler?
And we'll kill baby Hitler. So, on the CBS app, it's amazing. It's on the CBS app.
Well, speaking of baby Hitler, that was a meme from last year's election. If you could go back in time and kill baby Hitler, would you do it? It was, you know, I'm not going to do the joke. I had a joke in my act where I said I would have gone, instead of killing baby Hitler, I would have gone back in time and told the Jews to lower their voices. That's a bad joke. I apologize. But I did it on stage, and I'm ashamed of myself. So is the baby Hitler, he's, you know, baby hands, he's got baby hands, issued this executive order banning specifically Muslims from entering this country from 7 countries, I believe all in the Middle East. Is Iran included in that?
Oh, yeah. I think Iran actually had top bill on that one.
Now, you go back and you've traveled to Iran, right?
Yeah, to be honest with you, I was born in Iran. I left Iran late 78, and then I've only gone back once, almost 20 years ago, because my father had returned and was still alive. He's passed away. He passed away in 2009. So I went and visited him, I believe it was 1999 or so, and I was there for 2 weeks. And then after that, since I was doing stand-up and in some of my jokes I made fun of the Iranian leadership, I didn't dare to go back because I'm afraid. From what I've heard, a lot of times if you are in, if you're pretty prominent in Western media, they will accuse you of being a spy. So I really didn't need that. There was a lot of other countries I could go and visit that did not include Iran. I've been to a lot of the Arab countries and done stand-up in those countries.
Right, Lebanon, yeah.
Lebanon,
well,
and, you know.
Didn't you, last time you were on the show, you performed for Hezbollah, right? Weren't there people in the audience who were,
right? No, it wasn't. No, we were in Beirut, and someone had a great idea that me and the other two comedians, when we were doing Access to Evil in 2007, we were doing a behind-the-scenes documentary, and someone thought it'd be a great idea for us to go have lunch with Hezbollah. So we tried to set that into motion, and as we got closer to our destination, the guy who was our director started to quickly realize that these guys might not be Hezbollah, they might just be drug dealers, and he pulled us out of it. So never have had Hezbollah, as far as I know, I've never had Hezbollah in my audience, but I guess you never know. But listen, I've performed all over the Middle East, so when I heard about this travel ban, now a lot of these countries, as you know, a lot of the countries that have actually committed acts of terror in America aren't even on the list. Mm-hmm. Not that that would mean that those countries should be on a banned list either, but from my experiences, most of the people when I travel overseas are just good people trying to live their lives. And somebody made a couple of good points. One was that when you issue a ban like this, the fact is that terrorists are criminals. And so they have ways of getting in. It's the same argument that gun rights owners use. They say, if you put rules on guns, then the law-abiding ones will abide by it, but the criminals will get the guns. Well, the same thing can be played out right back at them when you say a lot of these terrorist acts that have happened in Europe have included fake passports. So what's to say that someone from ISIS is not going to go get a fake passport that's a Turkish passport in some other country and come in or sneak in? So I really don't understand the impetus. I know that it's political. I know that some of the countries that are on the list were actually put on that list under the Obama administration, because what had happened was, if you look at Iran is considered a state sponsor of terror because it supports Hezbollah as well as Hamas, and I think they were involved in fighting some Americans in Iraq. However, actual terrorist acts by an Iranian in America is just unheard of, and all the Iranians that I know come here to take advantage of the opportunities in America, and a lot of them want a better life. So I've done shows in some universities in strange places where you wouldn't expect to see Iranians, and you see these Iranians that are recent immigrants, and they're here on a student visa, and their goal is to get an engineering degree and work in America and have a good life. So those are the people that we're shutting out when we do this travel ban. Not to mention the innocent people. What happened was, I personally don't have relatives that are that close in Iran anymore, but I had a lot of people reach out to me because I got very active on social media. So a lot of people reached out to me with their stories, and I heard a lot of stories of some people needing medical attention who weren't able to come. Some people, one guy emailed me and said that he is caring for his uncle here in America, and that his cousin, who is a Norwegian, but also dual passport holder, Norwegian-Iranian, that cousin of his had gone through all of the hoops to get the right visa to come see his father on his deathbed. The father is very sick and old, and his visa had been canceled. So basically, he won't be able to see a dying father. So You hear a lot of these stories, and you go, you realize, because the way the administration has sold it, they said it's just an inconvenience. I have a Republican friend of mine. I was speaking to him, and he goes, let me ask you a question. Is it really that big of a deal if about 150 people were inconvenienced at the airport? And I said, bro, that's not the case. I heard Kellyanne Conway say that after September 11th, she had to go through further screening at the airports, and she didn't mind because she knew it was for her safety. And I agree with that 100%. When they wand me and look at my bags, I don't mind. That's just a slight inconvenience. You're talking about families being torn apart. You're talking about Syrian refugees, Somali refugees who've been living in refugee camps, who've been going through the vetting process, who sold all of their belongings because they were told that they are allowed to come to America, and then last minute got the pull rug out from under them, and they had no possessions. Another one that was kind of, and sorry I'm babbling here, but these
are... No, please, please.
Yeah, another one that was really interesting, it was kind of, somebody described it as almost a Shakespearean situation. This one Iranian lady, she emailed me, she goes, listen, I'm an Iranian who was studying in India. I met an American man, we fell in love, we got married, and obviously when you get married, then you can go in for the green card interview. You have to go to an embassy near your country, and there's no American embassy in Iran. So they were sent to Turkey, Ankara, to go in for their for her green card interview. She said, we landed in Turkey, and we got an email saying that our interview had been canceled. And she said, the problem is that Iran, to reciprocate, Iran banned Americans. So she said, my husband, who's American, can't go to Iran. I'm Iranian. I can't go to America. And she said, we're stuck in a hotel in Ankara. Please help. Mm.
So she contacted you because...
Because I was active on social media, and I was saying, please send me your stories. I will give voice to these stories. I was posting a lot of stories. I was, if you go to my Facebook at that of the that couple weeks ago, there's I don't usually post long diatribes, but I ended up doing two or three of those because what happened was, first of all, just out of pure empathy, I came to America running from the tumultuous situation in Iran, and I can't imagine even psychologically landing at JFK, feeling that we are free and we are now in the land of opportunity, and having them turn us around, put us on a plane, and send us back. Right. That actually happened, where they were sending people back. So I just can't imagine the psychological effects that would have on a 5-year-old, a 6-year-old, a 7-year-old, much less this family of people that have, you know, gone through all this process to get here. So that was one thing that really hit close. The other thing that was interesting was, when I posted it, I actually went down to LAX and I protested, and I felt good about it. It felt like it was a big, big numbers supporting the cause. But then I heard later that night that a majority of Americans still supported the travel ban. And I am a believer that Americans in general are pretty sympathetic people. I just feel that the way this thing was sold to them was in a way where they thought it was for their security and a few people have been inconvenienced. It reminded me, I feel that when we see a cause, a lot of times we don't get involved because we think someone else is going to take care of it. So, for example, it reminded me of when Black Lives Matter was on TV and I'd be watching it, but I never once felt like, oh, I should go down and support these guys. I just thought, oh, well, they're taking care of it. You know, they'll get someone to do it and they'll get their point across. So I feel the same thing goes in this case, where a lot of people that don't know anyone affected by this ban, they might sit there and go, well, it's making America safe, and it's just affecting a few people, so I support it. But I felt that what needed to happen was that more people needed to see the stories of the individuals affected. And when they saw those stories, my hope was that they would realize that there are real people whose lives are being turned upside down. And none of these people fit the profile of an ISIS terrorist. It's just, it's like saying, I want to stop immigrants coming in from Mexico, so I'm going to build a wall along Canada. It just doesn't make any sense. And now they're coming back with, they always have arguments. And one of their arguments was, and even Trump said, he said, my law enforcement officials said that I need to enact it right away. Because one of the criticisms was, well, why don't you just say, hey, this is going to go into effect March 31st. That way people had a little time to prepare. And then he said, well, my law enforcement officials said that if I did that, that would give the bad guys time to sneak in. And my reply to that is, are you kidding me? You think there's an ISIS guy right now sitting going like, oh my God, I got to get in by March 31st. No, that guy is going to find a way in, number one. Number two, the attacks we've had in our country have been homegrown. So rather than trying to stop people from coming in, you may want to do something else that will deal with that issue.
I remember after 9/11, reading an article in Foreign Affairs, and they said, we don't have the same problem Europe has in the United States because we've embraced Muslims. We've embraced the Arab community. The problem in France, the problem in London is Arabs and Muslims have a sense of being the other. And I remember George W. Bush, after 9/11, making it a point of visiting a mosque and embracing Islam. What happens to Muslims in America when they feel alienated?
Yeah, I think I see your point. I think you're right about that. I think that a lot of Muslims that come to America come from a bad situation. They are not, from what I know, I don't know the statistics, but I don't think that a lot of them are entitled. They're hard workers. I know for a fact that the Iranian community is a community that really works hard, and they set up businesses and they become doctors and lawyers and all kinds of stuff. So I don't feel that they are, like you said, for example, I was in Brussels and I wanted to go down to Molenbeek, which was that place where those terrorists had come from. And I went down there and you could see that there was poverty down there. So these people, and it was divided by a bridge. So on the other side of the bridge were the well-to-do Belgians, and on this side of the bridge were all the poor Algerians or Moroccans or whatever they were. And so you see that divide. In America, I don't think you have that. I think you have a lot of, like you said, members of the Muslim community, of the Arab community that really get involved. I mean, you know how it is. You get in a cab or an Uber, it's some guy from one of these countries always driving and hustling and doing three jobs. And the fact is, these people love America. And here's the other thing that's very interesting. If somebody like Trump were to step back and actually talk to some of these Muslim leaders, he would realize conservatives and Republicans have a lot more in common with Muslims than they think. Like, I'm talking about religious Muslims. Because first of all, let's draw another distinction here, which is a lot of Iranians aren't even religious. We left the Islamic Republic of Iran because we were turned off by it. It messed up our lives. So a lot of Iranians that I know are very secular. So even though I've been saying recently, jokingly, I've been saying I'm kind of Muslim-ish because I drink alcohol, I don't fast during Ramadan, I don't pray five times a day. You know, the only time I pray is I'm almost in a car accident and then I just go, oh, Jesus, which isn't even the right God. So, you know, it's the truth, and that's really true. So first of all, you have a lot of secular Muslims who don't even care. You know, they don't associate with this thing that Trump and company would have you believe about Sharia law and how we want Sharia law. So you have that, and then you've got the religious ones who actually have a lot more in common with Christians and with conservatives in that they also feel that marriage is not supposed to be gay marriage. They also are probably anti-abortion. They probably have a lot of conservative ideals. And so if somebody like Trump were to go and talk to some of these people, he would realize, oh, wow, we have a lot more in common. So I would hope that we would look for the commonality as opposed to as opposed to trying to say that these guys are here to kill us. They're not here to kill us. They're here to live the American dream. They're here to work hard. And it's just, I just don't know how else to get to people. I mean, statistics don't work, that's for sure. They're saying right now, the Trump administration now is saying that when people say, you know, no one from those seven countries that was on the list has ever committed an act of terror in the past 40 years in America, they're saying that some number like 75 people were flagged as having tried to commit an act of terror from those countries. Yeah. And as I was listening to the report, the lady said on NPR, she said a lot of those were people who had done passport fraud. So is that terrorism, or is that just someone doing passport fraud? And what were they doing the passport fraud for?
Well, let me tell you. I follow Chuck Woolery on my fake Twitter account. I'm obsessed with Chuck Woolery, the game show host, because you know, he's out of work, so he's become a rabid conservative, and he has some kind of podcast and sells gold. And he cited that statistic, and I thought, as my fake Twitter, I'm a woman when I'm in my fake account, I'm Dee Murphy. I followed the link, and they were dead links. It was traced back to a foreign relations subcommittee.
Yeah.
And then the link was dead and the evidence wasn't available, but it was shown to somebody from Fox News. So those numbers, there's no spreadsheet for those numbers.
No spreadsheet, and logic doesn't seem to play any kind of role in this, in trying to make people understand. I mean, that the whole Bowling Green massacre. What happens when she says Bowling Green massacre? So those guys were a couple of, I think, Iraqis who were trying to give some assistance to, I think, members of a terrorist group in the Middle East. But they didn't do anything themselves. They were caught before it happened. And so you have that. But then again, if you go back to the acts that have happened, it's been Pakistanis, it's been Saudis, it's been some of these other countries. And so you realize the politics that's being played here. And also, again, it's just like you said, I think what these guys are doing, it just turns people away. It does become a recruiting tool. I mean, if anything, again, the logic goes here. Iran is fighting ISIS. Iran is an enemy of ISIS. Even though Iran supports Hezbollah and Hamas, Americans don't seem to distinguish that. If anything, Iran can help us fight ISIS in Iraq. Again, I'm not at all a proponent of the Islamic regime, but that said, they can be an ally, because just like Saddam Hussein was able to control his country and we took him out and now we've got this mess, the same thing goes here. So there's no nuance when you try to break it down for some of these guys. And it's just, I am, you know, like I said, I am at the point where I feel like the best thing I can do is just share more and more individual stories of guys, another Iranian guy who's here now, he's a doctor, he's been here his whole life, went to Iran, met a girl, fell in love, got married, took a year to year and a half to get her visa, and now she can't come, and so they've been separated, and he was saying in this interview, he goes, I may have to make a decision, do I move to Canada? I love America, but I may have to move to Canada just so that I can have my wife with me.
Yeah. We had Charles Kurzman on the show. He's a professor from the University of North Carolina, and he studies terrorist attacks in the United States. And we have never been attacked. Well, I don't want to say that. I'll show you. Nicholas Kristof has a piece in the New York Times. I think it was on Sunday. And he quotes Charles Kurzman. And some of these stats are pretty incredible, that you're more likely to die falling off a ladder than you are from a Muslim terrorist. You're more likely to die slipping in the bathtub than you are from a Muslim terrorist. You're more likely to get hit by lightning than you are to be killed by a Muslim terrorist. You're more likely to die falling down the stairs than you are from a Muslim terrorist.
You know, they've done a good job of creating this boogeyman that is coming to get us. And the unfortunate thing is, if something were to occur, they right away go, see, we told you, we told you. Even the one in the Orlando shooting, Dave Chappelle did a funny bit about it on, when he hosted SNL, where he said this guy really wasn't aligned with ISIS. He just kind of gave a shout out to ISIS. He said it's kind of like me giving a shout out to whatever, like KRS-One as my show ends. So this guy did that, and we've come to find out he had mental problems. Maybe he was dealing with his own homosexuality or whatever. And then, of course, numbnut over here, Trump. I'm looking for this tweet. I'm sure it's out there around that same time. He comes out and he puts a tweet right after that. If my Muslim ban were in place, this guy would never be in our country. Okay, so you're saying the fact that this guy was born in Jersey means nothing to you. You're saying that if you'd gone back to 1970, whatever, 77, 78, whenever his father came, and retroactively put a Muslim ban on America, this guy would never have come. Okay, so you want us to go retroactively put a Muslim ban on America. Okay, and now when you are implementing your travel ban, Afghanistan, which is where their father came from, isn't even on the list. So, where's the logic here? And they keep coming out. They go, well, Obama put these guys on the list. Yeah, but the Obama administration did not come out one day and go, everyone's banned. They said that people from these countries need further scrutiny. This happened, the Iranians were up in arms because after San Bernardino, again, which had nothing to do with Iranians, Congress, because again, there was a big fight in Congress to try and sabotage the Iran deal. So Congress came out and they decided to lift this visa waiver that you had if you came from 30 some odd countries, including Iran, where you could come travel, I think with like a simple visa. But now they were saying that Iranians, I think it was called HR 158 or something, and now Iranians are going to be scrutinized even more when they travel to America, even dual citizen Iranians, which are, for example, my cousin might qualify for that. My cousin's lived in England since he was probably like 15 or 14 or something, and now he's like 50 something, and he's visited Iran a handful of times just to see if he can do anything with any of the properties he owns, but he doesn't go back that often. But if there's a stamp in his passport, or if they find out that he's got an Iranian passport, they may scrutinize him and deny him entrance into America. So it's very haphazard. It's very poorly thought out, and he keeps coming back with, you know, this is for our safety. But really, I mean, I don't see them being logical at all. And I don't know where it's going to lead. I don't know if it's going to lead to my worry is that we've seen that they started drumming the wars with the beating the drums of war with Iran. My worry is that this guy is so trigger happy, and those guys in his cabinet are so trigger happy that we may end up sending troops in some places, and then of course they'll sell it again as, this is what we need for our defense, and yada yada, and you know, here we go again.
Are we inoculated? I mentioned this earlier in the show. I maintain that George W. Bush inoculated us against a fake war. Do you think this time it's been seared into our memories and we're going to rise up and not fight it or allow it?
I don't know. You know, I would wish that's the case. But again, when I see how they get out this fake information, and somebody made a good point about fake information. Take the Bowling Green Massacre. She announces Bowling Green Massacre. It goes on everywhere, the Breitbart and all the other outlets. The Chuck Woolery retweets it. And by the time she comes back and fixes the problem, it's already been etched in their minds. So, and then they read about it and they go, oh, so it was two Iraqis who were trying to do something, but they didn't do something. Well, that's still dangerous. So I am just afraid of how easily people can be manipulated. One thing I learned about that, I don't have the statistics to prove this, but one conclusion I came to after this election is that most people in the world are conservative. And what I mean by that is, they don't want change. Most people, if you look at people living in poverty or what have you, they might want a better life, but they don't want to have their ethics or their beliefs rocked. So when you get a president coming in who's got progressive ideas and says gay marriage will be legal and we are going to lessen the coal industry and work towards cleaner air, and we are going to have a diplomacy with Iran and Cuba, and you start putting all this stuff out there, I think you see the backlash of people that are mostly conservative going, no, this is not what I want. I want jobs, and I want America first, and I want marriages between a guy and a girl, and abortion is not should not be legal. I think you get more and more of that. And I just hope the one thing that's been encouraging that I've seen is this backlash, the protests. I was just talking to somebody today. I was saying, I think it's about time for some Republicans to start shaking in their boots and go, wow, this guy really is erratic. He's very inexperienced. He's surrounded
unhinged.
By people. Unhinged. And if nothing else, listen, if I were a Republican, strategically speaking, and I don't like Mike Pence either with his policies, but strategically speaking, I would say, let's get this dude out, put Mike Pence in. He will push the same agenda that we want, but at least we won't end up with a tweet that's going to get the Chinese to launch a nuclear missile at one of our allies and lead to a war.
I'm just wondering, I was driving, listening to Trump's press conference with Justin Trudeau today, and
yeah.
Then they were talking about Flynn and then Mar-a-Lago, and North Korea launched a ballistic missile, a medium-range ballistic missile, and Donald Trump is at Mar-a-Lago talking to the guests about what he should do about North Korea, and people are saying, can you believe this? He's holding discussions with tourists, and he's not in the Situation Room, and there could be spies. And as I'm driving, I'm feeling good at the time, kind of smiling, I'm thinking, maybe the Situation Room and the Pentagon and the National Security Council and secrets and spies are all busy work and unnecessary. And the gift of Trump will be that he'll be a complete incompetent. Nobody will trust him, but no international incident will be escalated to a war because the military won't trust him. I'm just being optimistic here. And
yeah.
we'll discover that there can actually be a holistic approach to international affairs where, you know, if you don't touch anything, it'll heal. If I don't know. I'm just rambling here. I'm just kind of thinking that if America, you know, stayed out of the Middle East and stayed out of China and just didn't, you know, just didn't get involved, maybe we wouldn't be exacerbating the situation. For example, the travel ban, there are seven nations we're not allowing refugees and immigrants from. One of them is Yemen. Well, within the same week that we banned Yemenis from entering America, we launched an attack there that killed all these citizens, including an 8-year-old girl who happened to be an American citizen. Nobody talks about that. And the leaders of Yemen say, you know, we don't want you doing this anymore. And by the way, America isn't allowing any of your people to come. We're not allowing Iraq. We invaded Iraq. We committed war crimes. We violated UN sanctions and treaties. We're not allowing anybody in from Iraq. We're not allowing anybody in from Iran. What did we do to Iran? What did America and the United Kingdom do to Iran in the 50s?
That was the coup, the Mossadegh coup, where they took a democratically elected leader and they put in the Shah in place because the Shah would play ball with them. But you're absolutely right. I mean, somebody asked that too. They go, why do these people want to come here? Because we bombed their countries.
Mm-hmm.
We ruined their countries and they want to come here. And I wish what you said were true. It seems like you're right. I think this guy's governing from the car. You know, this guy's like the way I'm taking my calls in the car. This guy's governing on the run. But I honestly feel that the other problem is the people that he's surrounding himself with are ideologues, and you have your Steve Bannon, you have your Michael Flynn. I mean, there's videos of Michael Flynn. I'm sure you've seen it, saying that Sharia law is here to take over, and the Islam is an ideology. So I can see some of these guys encouraging us into a war. You know, they're doing tough talk. And, when they do tough talk, for example, with Iran, when they do tough talk, it just emboldens the regime because there's moderates there who were just like here. They were proponents of the Iran deal. But when tough talk comes from America, then the regime just does tough talk back, and then the regime can say, look, America really does have it out for us, so we can't have a nuclear deal with them. Let's go back to where we were.
You know, we had a tough talking George W. Bush, who spoke from the gut and bottom lined everything.
Yeah. Yeah.
Haven't we learned anything? I'm always amazed by the closer you get to people in authority, how stupid they are. That, you know, Mike Flynn, I think working in television, you'll meet somebody in a Brioni suit. They're tan, they have white chiclet teeth, and you think, oh, he's in charge. He's a network executive. He's wearing the uniform of the network. And then you begin to talk to him, and a complete moron. Just a complete moron. Just a company guy.
Yeah.
You can't believe that somebody can rise within the Trump organization or Trump himself. You can't believe that somebody could, like Mike Flynn, could rise within the military and be an idiot. But they're idiots.
Yeah, it's part of it is just they, you know, you stick, you don't rock the boat. You do what you're told. You move up the ranks and you don't think critically. And what's scary about Flynn and what's scary about his son and Bannon and even Trump, they are conspiracy theorists. They're conspiracy theorists, and they say one thing, but they've done another thing. And, I mean, Trump is notorious for that. I just saw a great piece from John Oliver where he showed that clip of Trump saying there was no rain at the inauguration, and we saw rain. I mean, first of all, why is that even an issue? But secondly, dude, there was rain. So that doesn't mean that God likes you or doesn't like you or whatever you want. That just means it rained. That means that the inauguration is on January 20th when it's winter in D.C. The fact that your numbers weren't that good at the inauguration doesn't mean necessarily that you don't still have your supporters. It could be that his supporters just didn't come out because they're where he was when he was doing the big rallies and they're just waiting for him to create jobs. But he is such a conspiracy theorist and just makes stuff up as he goes. That's really scary. I mean, to have
and they know what they're doing. They know what they know. But those lies, they know that they're lying. That's part of the playbook. That's what authoritarian regimes do: is that you lie consistently, and that lie is an act of aggression. They know that it's a lie. But they're saying, I'm going to lie to you and you're not going to be able to do anything. That is the playbook of authoritarian regimes. Before you go, you're doing comedy. I've only been doing comedy in Manhattan. I'm in a bubble. I'm on an island where no matter how much I make fun of Trump, the audience can't get enough of it. But some of my friends are spooked. They're working the road. And there's been a change because things that were once left unsaid are now being said out loud. People are feeling free to express racist viewpoints. And a lot of my friends who are comics straddle the line on stage where they're a little politically incorrect. Suddenly, people's butt cheeks are clenching up. They don't know what to do. There's a sea change in comedy right now.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think I saw a nice documentary on Netflix. It's called The Evolution of Hip Hop. Mm-hmm. And it was talking about how, I think it was either when Reagan came into power or it was when Bush 1 was in power, and there was this backlash from rappers where they got political. And that made me realize there is going to be a lot of political comedy, music, art that takes this stuff head on. I know that I'm doing it a lot. And like you said, I haven't been into the middle of the country yet, but I feel pretty emboldened to speak my mind because, again, I'm trying to come from a personal place. I'm not trying to yell at people, but I do want to tell them my personal story. Even at the Laugh Factory just this past weekend, I was doing some Trump material. There was a lady who was laughing, and her husband, who kind of fit the profile of a older white guy, who was just staring at me. And I almost stopped to ask him if he's okay. But then I thought, you know, it could be anything. It could be that this is just how he is. It could be that he's tired. Maybe he just doesn't like my jokes. And maybe if he doesn't like my jokes, then that's fine. What do I want to argue with this guy for? This is my point of view. That's why I'm a comedian. I'm going to give you my point of view. And I'm going to give you my point of view with actual stories of how this guy has affected me. So I think it's our time to talk. I think it's our time to put it out there, even if they push back. I remember during Bush, I had a few people yelling at me during sets, and I had to get into little yelling matches with them. So that hasn't happened yet.
This is a tough question. You know, you're a better comic than you were in 2001. So this is going to be a hard question for you to answer. Is it easier now or harder?
The only thing that's easier now is that I'm more confident in my point of view. So I'm comfortable going on stage and saying, hey, I'm a liberal. This is how I think. This is what I feel. And I even have, you know, there's a lot of immigrants who are conservative. And so I've had people that are immigrants, whether they're Iranians or Arabs or Somali or whatever, I've had them argue back with me. And it's interesting when I get in an argument with one of those guys. I was in Houston before the elections, and I do a joke where I refer to Trump, and I told my mom, you know, Mom, he's anti-immigrant. If he becomes president, your relatives can't come to visit you. And yeah. Some Lebanese guy yelled out, he goes, he's anti-illegal immigrant. And I go, excuse me? He's like, anti-illegal. I go, okay, bro, good luck to your cousins when this guy takes over. You see how he's going to, you know, differentiate between you, Hassan, and the rest of your relatives, you know?
Right.
We're
out of time. Hey, let's plug some gigs before I lose you. Maz
sure.
Jobrani, your new special is entitled I'm Not a Terrorist, but I've played one on television. Superior Donuts is on CBS Monday nights at 9 p.m. And if you follow Maz on Facebook, especially now, I think you can hear some chilling stories, and I would assume some advice on how we can help.
Absolutely. I'm staying active.
If you could tell my audience one thing to do, what would you tell them?
One thing to do is spread the stories of innocent people that are being affected. Get those out there so that more and more people on the other side can see the human toll that these policies are taking.
And if we go to your Facebook page, we can see those stories.
I have a bunch of those stories. I have comedy clips. I have everything. It's just everything. I'm on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. It's all at Maz Jobrani, which is MazJobrani. And they find me there.
Okay. Maz, come back real soon. Thank you.
Thanks, David. Appreciate it.
I want to thank Howie Klein and Maz Jobrani for doing the show today. By the way, Maz's stand-up show, the tour that he did with his fellow comedians right after 9/11, was called Axis of Evil. You talk about cojones. Traveled around the country, around the world, Axis of Evil. Keeping with the theme of people who need to go away but won't, like Ari Fleischer, Bill Kristol, Axis of Evil is a phrase coined by George W. Bush's speechwriter, David Frum. David Frum was a neoconservative, worked with Richard Perle, defended the war in Iraq. When I worked on the Bill Maher show, he would come on and tell us to give it time, give war a chance. Somehow, he has survived. Has a cover story in this month's Atlantic about autocracy. He's going after Trump, calling him a sociopath and dangerous and a threat to democracy. And yet this is the same guy, David Frum, who coined the phrase Axis of Evil and gave us the invasion of Iraq. In 2003, he wrote a book with Richard Perle defending the invasion of Iraq, advocating regime change in Iran and Syria. Suppose we had listened to him. He says he did vote for Hillary. He did vote for Hillary. And he has been very critical of conservatives, even before he joined the Bush White House. But if you're part of the cabal that invaded Iraq, you need to go away. You need to go away. You need to shut up. Or you need to write an apologetica. Apologize before you can just blend seamlessly into magazines like Atlantic Monthly and suddenly become a hero to the left because you voted for Hillary. These people need to go away. One final thought about Maz. Media Matters did a study. This is from Media Matters, Julia Alderman and Ina Mast. A 2014 Pew study shows that 38% of Americans know someone who is Muslim. Even fewer, obviously, know anybody who is affected by this ban, this executive order. This is terrifying. According to a YouGov poll taken in 2015, 55% of Americans have a somewhat unfavorable or very unfavorable opinion of Islam, while 50% said they understand the religion not too well or not well at all. 55% of Americans in 2015 say they have a somewhat unfavorable or very unfavorable opinion of Islam. That's pretty terrifying. That's pretty terrifying. The news media is not helping. When Donald Trump signed his executive order banning Muslims, I can't believe I'm saying this, when Donald Trump signed an executive order banning Muslims from seven predominantly Muslim countries that never attacked us, the cable news had a field day. And they had a total of 176 guests. This is according to Media Matters. 176 guests came on Fox, CNN, and MSNBC to opine on this executive order. Of those 176 guests, only 14 were Muslim. CNN had seven Muslim guests. MSNBC, the liberal network, had two. Fox hosted five Muslims. We need to do better. In 2015, when Chris Christie, there's talk of Chris Christie being brought back to run the White House, even though he put Jared Kushner's father in prison. When Chris Christie was running for president, he said in 2015, "We should not accept any Syrian refugees, not even orphans under the age of five." That's what Chris Christie said. There are no consequences for a statement like that. And the Republican Party almost won a primary or two saying that. In November of 2015, Chris Christie, the governor of New Jersey, said the United States should not accept any Syrian refugees, not even orphans under the age of five. I don't know if you know who Peter Souza is. He was President Obama's official photographer. He's retired, but he keeps posting his favorite pictures from the Obama years on either, I think it's Instagram. Everybody has seen this except me, so I'm going to bring it up. And I know you've all heard this, but I'm going to go ahead with it anyway. He had a picture of Alex. He posted a picture of Alex, the six-year-old boy who wrote to President Obama asking that he be given the Syrian boy who was photographed sitting in an ambulance. He asked that President Obama find that kid and let him have, Alex wanted him as a brother. And President Obama was so moved by the letter, he invited Alex to visit him at the Oval Office. It was actually the day Hillary lost, the day after Hillary lost. This is the letter Alex wrote. A lot of you have already heard it. I didn't until this week. "Dear President Obama, This is a 6-year-old boy. Remember the boy who was picked up by the ambulance in Syria? Can you please go get him and bring him to my home? Park in the driveway or on the street, and we will be waiting for you guys with flags, flowers, and balloons. We will give him a family, and he will be our brother. Catherine, my little sister, will be collecting butterflies and fireflies for him. In my school, I have a friend from Syria, Omar, and I will introduce him to Omar. We can all play together. We can invite him to birthday parties, and he will teach us another language. We can teach him English, too, just like my friend Aoto from Japan. Please tell him that his brother will be Alex, who is a very kind boy, just like him. Since he won't bring toys and doesn't have toys, Catherine will share her big blue stripy white bunny. And I will share my bike, and I will teach him how to ride it. I will teach him additions and subtractions in math, and he can smell Catherine's lip gloss penguin, which is green. She doesn't let anyone touch it. Thank you very much. I can't wait for you to come, Alex. Chris Christie in 2015 said, the U.S. should not accept any Syrian refugees, not even orphans, under the age of 5. The problem is that if you show that letter to Chris Christie, he would say, there's no way he wrote that letter. His parents wrote it. Guarantee you. That's what Chris Christie would say. Meanwhile, Chris Christie, according to a new Quinnipiac survey, is the most unpopular governor in the history of New Jersey. The worst governor, the least popular governor of New Jersey. Well, I wanted to say something about Rand Paul, who also ran against Trump. You know, Jeff Sessions is finishing up his first week as our attorney general. He long history of racism. He was rejected as a judge by the Senate in the late 80s because people like Ted Kennedy and Coretta Scott King wrote letters maintaining that Jeff Sessions was hell-bent on preventing African-Americans from voting, a problem that is actually getting worse in America. That's for another show. And Rand Paul, who many on the left think he may be an ally. They may think that Rand Paul may be an ally. He's the son of Ron Paul. It's the family of libertarians. And Rand is the senator from Kentucky. He made a statement last week where he said, you know, he almost voted against Jeff Sessions. He said he almost voted against Sessions because there were some things that he didn't like about Jeff Sessions. But the minute the Democrats called him a racist, that was just too mean. So his response was, I got to vote for Jeff Sessions. This is Rand Paul. He said, no person that I know wants to be called racist or that you're trying to prevent people from voting. Nobody wants to be accused of being racist or trying to prevent black people from voting. We may disagree on what the law is, but you don't attack someone's character. That was Rand Paul. He was offended that people were attacking Jeff Sessions' character, calling him a racist. Well, the evidence was there. And Rand Paul tried to take the high ground. Rand Paul has a history of racism, and so does his father, Ron Paul. Dr. Ron Paul from Texas, a lot of his newsletters written when he was a congressman were penned by inveterate racists, people with a long history of racism. There's a long history of racism in the Rand Ron Paul family. There's a long history of racism in the Libertarian Party. Remember, they're the people who believe in states' rights. They're the people who believe in small government, right? Why do they believe in it? Because big government enforces Brown versus the Board of Education. Big government sends Nicholas Katzenbach from the Justice Department to stand on the steps and confront George Wallace and say, you need to accept black students. That's what big government does. Well, you can't say, I don't want to mix the races, but you can say you're a libertarian. And what a libertarian says is states' rights. That's dog whistle for I should be allowed to keep black people and Mexicans out of my community, out of my schools. I won't talk about Ron Paul's racism. Rand Paul, when he was running for president, said he would have opposed the Civil Rights Act of 1964. He said it was unfair that Congress passed a law telling businesses who they had to accept as customers. Remember the black men sitting at the Woolworth counter not being served? And then they were dragged out by the police. Rand Paul was against the Civil Rights Act of 1964 because he felt nobody had the right to tell Woolworth they had to serve black men. As a senator, when Rand Paul was gearing up for his presidential run back in 2013, he had a social media director named Jack Hunter. They were friends, and they co-authored a book about the Tea Party in 2011. Well, it was discovered that his friend Jack Hunter had another life. He was a radio shock jock who wrapped himself literally in the Confederate flag. On his show, he called himself the Southern Avenger, had a long storied history of making racist comments on his show, celebrating Abraham Lincoln's assassination. In 2009, when he was running for Senate, his campaign spokesman was discovered to have a MySpace webpage. Remember MySpace? MySpace webpage that included a comment on Martin Luther King Day that read, Happy N-Word Day. And above that was a photo of a lynching. Now, someone else posted that comment, but it remained on his MySpace page for 2 years. Rand Paul didn't want to, but he ended up firing both men, but insisted they didn't have any racist tendencies. Blamed the media for unfairly using his campaign workers as target practice. Paul said their activities were not racist. None of it was racist. That's Rand Paul, who voted for Jeff Sessions, decided to confirm Jeff Sessions as Attorney General, because he didn't like the fact that the Democrats were impugning Sessions' character by calling him a racist. Let's do some quick letters, and then I'm going to wrap it up. Max writes, I really enjoy David's podcast, but recently he started releasing these gigantic episodes that really should be 4 or 5 separate files. Anything over 90 minutes becomes like water torture. It's just too much of one person's voice talking and talking. I don't understand the reason for this, as most of these over 3 hours long epics are 4 or 5 separate long interviews with no unifying theme to connect them. Please have mercy. 8 hours per week from one podcast is just too much. Well, Max, I agree, but I have to do this. This is all I've got. It's Valentine's Day, Max. You're the love of my life. I'm divorced. I apologize. I don't know what to tell you. We've decided to drop the shows Tuesdays and Fridays at 3 a.m. Tuesday at 3 a.m. and Friday at 3 a.m. We drop the shows. And things are building up. We're in crisis. I'm in crisis. I have to do this. So I apologize for the length, but not the girth. These shows are important to me, and I need to connect with my listeners. This is what's keeping me sane and keeping me thinking. And so my recommendation, Max, is if the show drops at 3 a.m. on Tuesday, listen to an hour Tuesday morning, listen to an hour on Wednesday, listen to an hour on Thursday. That's 3 hours. That's the show. The next show drops Friday at 3 a.m. You've got the whole weekend to listen to the show. Listen to it in small pieces. That's how I would listen to it. A couple more letters. By the way, we have a contact button. If you go to davidfeldmanshow.com and hit the contact button, I'll read your letter on my show. I'll try to get to all the letters. And if I read one of your letters on my show, you send me a T-shirt. You get to send me a T-shirt. David Peckman wrote a letter. David Peckman writes in Liar, Liar, Pants on Fire. You know, that letter's just too long. It's about the fact checker column from The Washington Post. I agree with you, David. Stu writes, thanks for recommending the movie Autofocus. Thanks for having Eddie back. More Laura House, please. Hey, I'm a smart person. I went to Wharton Business School. I'm sorry. This is turned into Trump for a second. Yeah, Autofocus. Great movie. Greg Kinnear. Rent Autofocus. Eddie Pepitone. If you haven't heard the first 30 minutes of Friday's show, go listen to it. Eddie Pepitone. Eddie is a genius. Eddie Pepitone was my muse back in 2009, 2010, up until about 2013, and then he got too big. But he was my muse. We used to do sketch shows and sitcoms on this podcast. Eddie's my muse. I miss him. He's in L.A. and I'm in New York. This comes from Paul Michael Bailey. As you know, I've been with Howie Klein. I was talking about being a vegetarian. Obviously, I've talked about being a vegetarian a lot on this show. So he wrote in, I think refusing to use or eat any animal products 3 times a week is an ideal goal. But I think your advice is targeted to a very limited audience. I have no information on your podcast specific demographics. Well, Colleen Worthman did a study. We're basement masturbators. People have been reminding me of that. We're basement masturbators. I have no information on your basement masturbators. I have no information. I'm almost finished. I have no information on your podcast's specific demographics, but my intuition says the majority of your audience is not even vegetarian, let alone vegan. I recommend using your podium to start with the base and build. I would suggest saying meat eaters should be advised to eat vegetarian 3 times a week and then work up to 7 days a week. I agree. In our society, a vegan diet is a little radical, not to mention the stringent parameters of a vegan lifestyle by avoiding all interaction with all animal products. My 2 cents worth, Paul Michael Bailey. I agree with you. In fact, I can't do the vegan diet every day. It's tough. I end up eating cheese and eggs occasionally. That being said, I'm right for telling people to be vegan, even though I can't be vegan, but it's right. It's the right way to go. And it's hard, but you'll feel better. And you won't be consuming or supporting the machine. If you want to throw yourself on the machine, one way is stop consuming what the machine produces. Tony Duke, you know, Tony has been listening to this show since 2009. He's been, wow. We started in, I think, July of 2009. I was Mark Maron's, second guest on his podcast in 2009, before his podcast took off. And I was so patronizing to him, just saying, you know, I think you're going to enjoy this. And now I'm eating his dust, but that's okay. Tony Duke writes, David, trying to remember, was it Rick Overton who on your show described the situation with the Bush years as analogous? Analogous. It looks like analogous. It sounds like something performed in order to get a job at Breitbart Media. What was it? Describe the situation with the Bush years as analogous. I can't say the word. Analogous to movie
to the movie War of the Worlds. Can't remember his thesis, but I agreed with him. I'm wondering if he'll feel the same regarding Trump. I think we might be in a similar situation. Get him on the show ASAP, please. Laugh out loud, Tony. Yeah, Rick Overton. Went to Dwight Morrow High School with me. And Lee Gray writes, hi, David. Do you and your U.S. listeners have access to Al Jazeera? Here in New Zealand, it is a free-to-air channel on public TV. They have been showing this excellent documentary called The Big Picture, The Making and Breaking of Europe. It's very on point and is clearly designed to show parallels with Trumpism and the rise of the far right at various times in the past. History repeats, and we continue to fail to learn from our mistakes. The similarities are amazing, and they aren't just limited to the obvious ones. Keep up the resistance. Your show is one of my first stops to keep me motivated. P.S. I watched Hypernormalization after you mentioned it the other week. His last one, Bitter Lake, is very good, as are all his past documentaries. Joshua Seibelman, I think I'm pronouncing that right, actually recommended Hypernormalization to me. All right, that's our show. Again, going long, we're all in crisis, and this is how I'm dealing with it. I choose to do this, and I thank my listeners for writing to me and criticizing me and suggesting articles and documentaries and topics. I wish you all a happy Valentine's Day. This is manufactured by chocolate and diamond merchants. If you're alone on Valentine's Day, join the club. These holidays are ways to make you feel inadequate and alone, which we all are. Even people who are in love end up alone. That's not true. We're not alone. We're not alone. You know when you're alone? When you cut yourself off from others and only care about feathering your own nest. Donald Trump is alone. He's a borderline personality, incapable of connecting with any human being. If you feel alone, we're all alone. Join the club. And if you join the club, then you're not alone. And one of the best ways not to be alone is to go to these protests. That's what I'm going to do this weekend. I'm going to go to the protests. All right. Please friend me on Facebook. Follow me on Twitter. If you want to help me out, go to davidfeldmanshow.com and say hello. Hit the contact button. Tell me what you like about the show. Tell me what you don't like about the show. Support the show by then clicking on our Amazon banners and then shopping on Amazon. If you shop on Amazon through my site, we get, I think, 6% of everything you purchase. It's pretty good. Just go to davidfeldmanshow.com. You'll see Amazon banners and you click on them and shop away. Do all your Amazon shopping and it doesn't cost you extra. Become a monthly subscriber for $5 a month. You can gain access to our premium content, $5 a month. We post special episodes, special clips, and it's a good way to support this show. Some of you give more, like Jonathan Halper. Some of you give more than $5. It depends if you have the money or not and what you think is important. From the show Briz Studios in downtown Manhattan, that'll do it for us.